Okay, it's officially 6 o'clock, so I'd like to open the meeting. And are there any adjustments to the agenda?
Not for me.
Okay. I have a couple. I know we had, there was a note about talking about alcohol use for the town hall. So that's one thing that we'll discuss tonight. And then I just have an announcement about the town forest, the trail grant, that I would like to share with everyone. Is there any public comment? There's some members of the public here.
We're here to discuss the potential paving on category.
Okay, do you want to wait until we get to it? It's kind of towards the end of the meeting. We could, I have a feeling we're going to have a chunk of time before we get to the Woodbury School roof bid opening. So we could try to do that beforehand, because I assume that's why Jim and Brandy, you're here also for that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We're not opening the roof bids though tonight.
Yes, we are.
Even without the school?
Yep.
Patrick's supposed to be here, right?
Patrick is coming for that. It's up to the select board to, you know, we had talked about opening the bids. Okay, I can explain. I was going to wait till we get there, but we had talked about opening the bids with the school board. However, most of the school board is at the meeting in Hardwick. So this is the date that we have scheduled with the RFP to open the bids. So we are going to open the bids tonight. The only thing that we're going to do tonight is open the bids and make note of who submitted bids. And then later on this week, I'm going to meet with Larry Eldred. We're going to go over the bids and vet the different people that have bidded. And then together at our next select board meeting, and with many people from the school board want to come, we'll make a decision together. But ultimately, it's up to the select board, being the owner of the school, to make that decision. So that's kind of what's happening with the bids. And I know that Patrick is coming for the bid opening. And it's scheduled at 6:30, so I'm going to wait until he gets here to do that. So let's see. Let's do some of the routine business, and then maybe we can get on to the Cabot Road paving. So I would make a motion that we approve the bills to the town.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And then I would make a motion that we approve the minutes to the March 25th, 2019 Select Board meeting.
Second.
In favor?
Aye.
Okay, and I'll find those and sign them. Around. So I'm just going to make a brief report for the town treasurer, who's not feeling very well tonight. She just wanted to mention that $6,000 was transferred from the money market fund for to pay bills this day. And then there were a couple other things that I had wanted to discuss with you, but I'll save it for when you're feeling better. We won't do it tonight. Okay, so we can bump town official appointments for later. So why don't we get on to the town highway report, specifically the paving grant, paving fund, paving the village, and the Swenson reimbursement to the highway fund. Those are all related. I listed them so that they would all be there. And rather than I was going to go over the paving grant and the thoughts on how to pay for the paving with the select board. I could do that, or I'm kind of curious to, I have a feeling I know why you're here, but I would like to maybe give you the chance to just whatever comments that you wanted to make first.
So Diana had typed up. There's one for each of you.
Okay. Let's see. It's going to be hard for me really to focus on reading this right now. I could read it out loud, or does somebody just want to share the points that are in here? And it's going to take us probably at least 10 minutes to read this. But
yeah, we can read this later and just get to...
Yeah. And thank you for doing this,
yep.
But Diana
did it.
Diana did it.
We just got them too. So.
Oh, okay. I thought you guys had done them. Well, it's too bad she couldn't have sent them earlier. But.
All right, so the first question that I have is in relation to the grant that mm-hmm. it appears that the town, you on behalf of the town, is applying for. It's a highway grant mm-hmm. to... And if awarded this grant, it will provide money for much-needed paving in the town of Woodbury. Is that the premise of the grant? I'm just trying to understand the grant first
before
I get on to other things.
The grant is can only be used on Class 2 roads. So the different paving projects that we have that we've been talking about, the Upper Cabot Road, the bottom of Valley Lake Road, the street, I'm going to call it a street in front of the fire station and the town hall. Those two, the two sections of paving in the village are not Class 2 roads. So we are not eligible for a paving grant for that paving project that we're talking about. So the only thing the paving grant would apply for is the Upper Cabot Road. The thought at present is to pave from where the paving ends by Flat Street up to the new proposed entrance to the quarry, which is about a mile. So that's what the paving grant is for. The select board at our last meeting voted to apply for the paving grant. The application has been sent into VTrans. However, I have questions about this whole project myself, which I planned on sharing tonight. We can pull that application if we decide to.
Or, I mean, if you're awarded it, it doesn't necessarily mean that we have to use it.
Correct.
No, if we're awarded it, we have to use it.
You have
for
to use
that
it.
Project.
For that, yeah, that's
well,
the only project. That's the only project
we're right, right, but using. If we didn't end up using it, it would just get rotated back into the...
If we decide that we aren't going to use it, we're going to let VTrans
let it,
go.
Okay. All right. Understood.
Otherwise, you know, we would have 30 months once we're awarded the grant, but it's preferred by VTrans that you use the money
okay.
when you get it rather than sitting on it, because that means there are other places, towns that aren't able to use it.
And there's no other Class 2 road in the town of Woodbury that would benefit from that other than
not at the moment, no. There's only two, as my understanding is, there's only two Class 2 roads, Cabot Road and Foster Hill Road, to a certain
And it's designated as a Class 2 because, what's the designation?
There is special requirements for Class 2, and you need state approval to designate a road as Class 2. We tried to get Valley Lake Road, especially the part by the school, designated as a Class 2 road. It was a whole kind of convoluted form that we had to fill out, and then we submitted it to VTrans, and they said, sorry, it doesn't meet all of the criteria. There's a certain kind of point award system for different aspects of the road.
So if we end up getting that, and we end up doing that, and then Class 2 roads came up and needed fixing, how long would it be before our name came back up to get grants again for Class 2 roads?
It's about a 3 or 4 year cycle. So, you know, like we repaved the lower part of Cabot Road about 3, maybe 4 years ago. So we're golden for another paving grant at this point. So it's about a 3 or 4 year cycle. You know, if we were doing it every year, chances are we would
get it every year.
So are you invited to apply for this grant, or if there's basically a need or a potential need for this money, the town would opt to just want to apply for it?
Yes, the reason that we're applying this year is that 3 or 4 years ago, we had the intention of paving the upper part of Cabot Road, and this was, at that point, just to the present quarry entry road, Fletcher Quarry Road. And there was an objection at town meeting, and my understanding of the objection was that the town would be spending their money to pave the road. And of course, the intention of paving the road up there is to the benefit of the quarry. And mostly because, you know, during mud season, they have to kind of wait to send the granite out. So the whole intention, both then and now, is to benefit the quarry. So at that point in time, it was shot down at town meeting. People objected to spending the town money. So since that time, the Swenson Quarry gives the town about $30,000 a year reimbursement, pretty much for the upkeep of that particular road, the road that they use. And money from the Swenson Quarry has been designated to go into our paving fund every year. And so we had built up a fair amount of money, $43,000 in the paving fund. And based on the estimates from 3 or 4 years ago, that was enough money to do the paving. So we had started talking about applying for the paving grant from VTrans. Then Swenson Quarry submits an Act 250 amendment to their permit that they want a new access road. So the select board discussed, well, you know, maybe we should pave it all the way up to the new access road. So when we had someone come to give us an estimate, we got an estimate up to the Fletcher Quarry Road, and then we got an estimate to go all the way up to the new access road that they proposed, which significantly increased the cost, which is one of my concerns that I want to talk about tonight also. So that's kind of the history of the paving, you know, the paving on, the thinking behind paving the Upper Cabot Road, and the use of the grant. The grant gives the town, the maximum for the grant is $175,000, and then there's a 20% match from the town, which, you know,
well, that'd be like $36,000.
Right, which we, with the $43,000 in our paving fund, we could cover. But the original grant 4 years ago, and granted the price of pavement has probably gone up, but was about $20,000. So our thinking this time around was, okay, we've got $43,000 in the paving fund. The majority of that has come from the Swenson Quarry. To the estimate previous for paving up to the Fletcher Quarry Road was $20,000. So we could easily meet the match, because, you know, I don't know what because we were looking at paving all the way up, I don't know what the full amount was. I do have an estimate where I could figure that out, but I haven't even kind of looked at that, because we were just talking about going.
So who's on the hook for the extra maintenance that comes down the road, like the extra salting, the guardrails?
That's also what we've been doing with the Swenson Quarry reimbursement is, there's another percentage of the reimbursement that we get from them that goes specifically to road salt. So they've basically been paying for the town's road salt for 3 or 4 years. And, you know, I clocked the distance with the pavement on Foster Hill Road and the pavement up to Flat Street, and basically it's about 3/10 of a mile here and 3/10 of a mile there. So they've been paying for all of the road salt for both this road and the paved part of Cabot Road for a few years. One of the issues that I have is that the expense for, it's basically with that mile, we have about a half mile of paved roads right now. Paving another mile up to the new quarry entrance is going to triple our road salt budget, which, you know, we were spending about $11,000 a year on road salt. It's going to go up to $33,000.
Just in that section, just for that additional paving,
well,
that road.
Well, I could subtract a little bit for here. In fact, I have, so.
Well, that road will never hold up to just paving. Just pave it and then.
Well, it has a really good base, and you know, I don't know enough to argue that point with you. The dirt road itself has a really good base.
There really is,
there is no erosion issue. Well, because that's a good point. I agree, that's a good point. The paving that we did on the lower part of the Cabot Road, Skip researched a special mix that would hold up with the granite trucks, and so far it seems to be doing fine. So we would definitely use the same mix.
It's the same mix that's used on these roads.
No, it isn't. It's a special mix. Sorry, that I know for sure.
Now, have you given any thought to like a truck runaway ramp from the top of the hill, like down to the current road?
Have not done that. No
guardrails.
There probably would be some guardrails.
People go crazy on that road.
So I have a couple more questions in terms of the money. As far as what Swenson's currently provides or gives to the town based on their use of the road and their agreement in order to mine up there. So they give a certain amount of money per ton.
Right, and I can tell you what that is. They give 6.5 cents per cubic foot of usable granite, which Diana very handily figured out for me, and bear with me, let me find the piece of paper that's on. She extrapolated what their kind of yearly average payment is to us and came up with a figure of 461,000 cubic feet of usable granite. So that's not the granite that's coming down off the hill. That's what they're able to use in wherever they process the granite in Barrie. But that's where our reimbursement comes from. So, and obviously if we go ahead with this paving, they're going to have to pay more.
So a couple
more questions to that. Okay. So the first one is it in the agreement? Now, obviously you mentioned earlier that the money that is paid by Swenson, a good portion of that money is used for the maintenance of the road.
All of it is supposed
all
to
of it. So it, in the agreement between Swenson and the town, whatever money they pay based on that 6 cents per cubic feet or whatever it is, that money is held specifically for the road, Cabot Road.
It is now, but for many years it wasn't. It just went into the general fund. So the town really wasn't living up to their agreement with Swenson.
The expenses were still there. It's just we weren't itemizing it. Right. The expenses were still there.
Okay, and so based on what they've been pulling out and what they've been paying us and the actual cost to maintain that road, hence you now have that $43,000 surplus.
It's not a surplus, it's a paving reserve fund.
So out of the money that they've paid us, the town is taking money from there with the expectation that someday that road would be paved. And is that an agreement?
We aren't. That the reserve fund just builds. We don't take anything out of it until we use it for paving.
I understand, but you were putting. So you must have taken some of that money and dispersed it into that fund.
Yes, like I explained before, 25% of what the yearly amount that we get from Swenson.
And that was based on the expectation that the road would eventually or ultimately be paved.
Yes.
Is that an agreement that the town has with Swenson?
It's not an agreement, no, not a written agreement or even a verbal agreement. I think it's just a feeling. You know, I was on the select board when we first tried to pave that road, and after it got shot down at town meeting, you know, the select board just said, well, you know, we'll put money into the paving fund, and when it builds up sometime in the future, you know, we'll pursue that project again. And that's kind of what you know, the time has passed 4 years or so we're pursuing that project again. It's basically a courtesy to the quarry. I mean, and if people object to that, that's fine. You know, we can live with the dirt road the way it is. It's an excellent shape, and you know, and it only is an issue for the quarry during mud season, basically.
So, which is, one would hope, less than, you know, 1 month, but potentially mm-hmm. can be longer than really. That.
She's looking on the sunny side.
We all should.
I mean, as a resident of the town, and especially in that area, I have some pretty serious concerns about paving that road.
Uh-huh.
That have really nothing to do with mud season.
Okay, can you share those with us?
Certainly. Speed. Mm-hmm. I think that I walk that road just about every day, mm-hmm. and I can tell you that speed is an issue. Mm-hmm. And no one monitors the 30 mile an hour speed limit or 25 or 15 miles an hour during school time. And
yeah, I think it's 35 on that road.
I have been in the situation where the pavement ends and the dirt begins, that I've literally seen people losing control because they're traveling too fast.
They hit the potholes.
And they hit the potholes mm-hmm. and they slow down.
So we're talking cars, not
I'm talking cars, right? Okay. So you know, we're talking about one user of the road, that being Swenson Granite, that this would benefit. But I really, honestly, don't see any benefits to the rest of the people who use the road or live
well,
on that
the
road.
People that live further up the hill probably would see it as a benefit. The road would be salted during the winter. And
to walk up
probably
houses.
Would be a little bit easier to get
but
up the hill.
As it is now, we well, have people that can't make it yeah. up in the winter, yeah. and it's just, even the granite trucks, it's a...
Can't make it up to Flat Street?
Making
or
no. it up the paved section.
But the granite trucks are also supposed to use chains in the wintertime. Supposed to.
Right, but we
they used
are.
To.
Erica Tatro, Erica Smith, mm-hmm. had come in five mm-hmm. times last year, stated in the form that she couldn't make it up. Because mm-hmm. it was black ice right in
we
that
had
section.
People renting off the same thing. They call us up, can make up the hill. She comes
up.
home at 11 o'clock in the morning from Montpelier. She's walking up that road all by herself. And
the paved portion or the
paved portion? Because it's not paved. It's too slippery to make it up.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't even take care of the road now when it comes to plowing. We've had that conversation with an accident up there this year. And we had an accident, and when the insurance companies came to measure the road, right in front of Brandy's house, from the yellow line to the snowbank was 3.5 feet. Mm-hmm. And then up where the accident was from the yellow line to the snowbank, was 3 feet. Mm-hmm. The overall width of the road was 16. The vehicles were 18 feet wide combined. So mm-hmm. eventually somebody's going to hit, and we did. It was a head-on collision. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you can't take care of the hill, how are they going to take care of that?
But mm-hmm. you put two granite trucks next to each other.
Okay, you've got to sit at the bottom and look up. If there's a granite truck coming, you stay off it, because when they come around that corner by their house, the front end is on their side, the ass end's on the other side, mm-hmm. and then the middle of the truck is in the other lane. Mm-hmm.
So you don't believe that the Cabot Road has been taken care of the way it should have this year?
No, absolutely no question about it. No, we've had people come out and measure it. Insurance companies came out and measured it. And
has anybody come to the town or anybody? Or
I don't know. I know insurance companies are going to come to the town and talk to you guys about
this
it.
This is the first I've heard.
Yeah.
But getting back,
pictures of it, measurements of it. Mm-hmm.
I see the speed's going to be an issue. It's not mm-hmm. monitored by any local law enforcement or state law enforcement, so I'm very concerned about that. Right. I'm concerned that there's going to be more traffic than, you know, people already use the Cabot Road as an access point to get from Cabot to Woodbury. Mm-hmm. And I think
right,
the more
it's a class 2 road.
And yeah. I think that the more that you pave it, the more traffic there's actually going to be on that road. Mm-hmm. And people are going to go too fast. Now, you probably don't have the problem with the granite trucks because they can only go so fast.
Yeah,
but we're dealing with the traffic, the other traffic that's mm-hmm. on there. Mm-hmm. And I think at the very least there needs to be more consideration given to a traffic flow study or something of that nature that shows how much traffic is actually being used on that, and even monitoring the speed limits and mm-hmm. seeing how people are traveling. Mm-hmm. So I can guarantee you they're going to go faster, and it's right. dangerous. I have on more than one occasion sort of like flagged people down, like you've got to slow down. Mm-hmm. People come around those corners, not just from at the top there where, I don't know, right directly across from the class 4, which is one of my main concerns of having that access road up there, because I don't care what they tell you or what they say, that is going to be very tight for two trucks to come along and try to get one coming mm-hmm. down and one going up. Mm-hmm. In fact, when you're walking back from
or towards town, you have to really be paying attention to exactly where you're walking.
The town has no control of whether or not they get that access road.
I understand that, but I don't want to, in my opinion, we're encouraging it by adding paving to the mix. Now, I also know that at the meeting last week, Mr. Swenson, or is he just a manager?
He was there, yeah.
He mentioned that they have no plans to extract any more than what they're already extracting. But I know how these things work, and I can bet your bottom dollar that once they get their access road and they get their paved road, it's just a matter of time. And they're still working within their permit, so they're not doing anything.
Right. And that, you know, the hearing the other night was not about how much they're extracting.
And I understand that, but these are all things that are going to encourage that. And I don't, I'm not discouraging anyone from in business. I'm just saying that I don't believe that it is in the interest of the people who are living on that road to be paving it.
Okay.
Regardless of the fact that we have money available in the fund to do that.
Right. There was, a few years ago, we did quite a bit of speeds, weight studies on a lot of different roads. I don't know if we did the Cabot Road or not. I'll have to go back and look. But that is something that we could do, and if we didn't do it, maybe we should. It doesn't cost the town anything. The Regional Planning Commission does it. They, you know, the cables that you see across the road.
Do they do dirt roads as well?
Yeah.
So they can do right up the hill.
Yeah, we did a number of dirt roads a few years ago.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea to do this spring.
I have a list. We may have done the Cabot Road. I just can't remember offhand that we did.
And honestly, you know, the Cabot Road, you know, people are developing up there. There's more traffic there than there was, 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah, there is some.
We've been on the hill for 30 years now, and there's definitely more traffic.
I think all the roads in town are the same way. There's just a lot more traffic and more people moving to town. So all of our roads are getting a lot more use,
that's for sure.
Yeah.
That and with the paving, Montpelier's doing experiments turning paved roads back into dirt roads.
There are a lot of, actually that's
a big thing
a
going on right now.
Different places.
And they're saying that, put it back, so.
Yeah. Due to the keep up.
They say it's cheaper to upkeep a dirt road, obviously it is, than a paved, so.
Yeah, and like I said, I mean, I've seen it, them granite trucks, they may not affect the road the first year, maybe the second year, but trust me, that road is nowhere near in the shape it needs to be to hold up the granite trucks on blacktop. It just won't do it, it will not happen. You see it on this road, I mean, look, they've dug this down 4 feet and put a good base in, and the road's just still collapsing. It may not have happened the first 2-3 years, but it happens over time, and then who's going to be on the hook for it?
But it's not only granite trucks using this road out here either.
This is true.
This is true.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. But even then, there are aspects of their future. Within 10 years, they're hoping to pull 11 loads out of there, and it's 7 right now. That's daily.
With the previous Act 250 permit, they haven't reached anywhere near the amount that they were allowed to extract. So yeah, there will be more loads coming down. And that it's not an issue really with the road as a dirt road is really probably the best road we have in town. There are not a lot of erosion issues with it. The road crew did ditch it and pretty well a few years ago, and that's part of the thinking of that there really wouldn't be a lot of base work that would need to be done because the road is pretty solid. Plus, it's had granite trucks to pack it down nicely, I guess. But this is not a done deal, and it's. I have a whole convoluted series of figures that I was going to share with the select board, and if you want to bear with me, that's fine. Or I know Patrick is here, and we did have scheduled to open up the bids for the roof.
I just want to one more. Take consideration of the people that are going to be on that, because I think you're going to find out a lot. You're going to find a lot more that don't want and do.
People live on that
road. Live on that dirt road
because it is a dirt road.
Right.
They want to live on the highway.
Yeah. Well, if they knew, some of them knew about it, they would be here tonight. Mm-hmm.
I mean, the noise issues, it's not going to be changed whether the road is paved or dirt.
No, and that's true. And over, as I said, we've been on the hill for 30 years, and we've just come to accept that,
right.
That the nice, tranquil, peaceful country road that once was is not anymore. And I guess the only thing that I would say to that.
They were extracting granite when you.
Not to the capacity that they are doing it now. And not in the, there were more restrictions in terms of when they could actually.
Looks okay in our spot.
I'll be back if it's nothing.
Okay.
I think that they just.
Don't forget your hat.
Yeah, I do think that we should do a traffic study there this spring and summer, just because we're not there yet anyways, and see. And maybe talk to some more of the people on the hill and see. I would have expected a lot of them would want it paved in front of their place, but. Yeah, I don't know. Nobody else has come in forward and said anything, but what do you got? Just Ron Brooks and across the road and only about four people once you get on the pavement up there. So I would think that probably the Ainsworth girl would want it paved so she could get up and down the hill the winter with it.
But paving it is not always going to, it's not going to satisfy that issue because, you know,
like say, even the hill's paved, but there's so many times you can't make up that hill. So that
times you can't make it, right?
I can tell you for sure the Demers family is 100% against it.
Yeah, and the thing is,
I can tell you that for sure.
God forbid, being aimless up that hill, 4 or 5 inches of snow in the ground, they didn't make it. Mm-hmm. And it should be kept clean.
Well, the town would certainly save a lot of money if it wasn't paved. So,
yeah.
Just figure, you say they pay for the salt with the funds. But there's a lot of extra man hours with that salt. I mean, they go up down that road a lot in the morning.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's not paid out of that. That's just the salt.
Well, yeah.
they're going to have to go up and down it anyways, whether they're salting it or
sanding. No, I know, but they go up to Flat Street, turn around, come back
the
down.
Yeah, it's all the
way up. The pavement.
When there's a snowstorm, the first thing that the road crew does is plow and salt this road, and then they go right up to your road and do that. Just because as cars drive on the snow on the paved roads, of course it packs and it turns into ice.
Well, they get to work. I mean, they get to haul.
So
I always drop my plow. Whenever I head out at 3 or 4 in the morning to go plow, and I'll drop my plow to help anybody that needs to get up there. I'll send you a bill on that. Don't worry about it.
Yeah. This isn't a done deal yet. This is early thoughts, and if we get more people coming in, I'd love to see Ron Brooks and maybe Mark. Throw their hats in the ring and let us know what they think as well, because they're, I'm not sure who lives across from Ron Brooks, but.
Wayne Prescott.
No, it's up the hill.
Phil Edson.
Yeah, it'd be nice to hear from.
But even Wayne.
Wayne. Sabina.
Probably half of them don't even know.
You know what would be helpful is if you guys want to do a Cabot Road survey, that would be really helpful. I have plenty to do otherwise, but if you know those folks and know how they feel or are willing to just go and talk to them about it and, want to report back, that would be a great help.
Can we just put it on the agenda and...
For next meeting?
Right.
That you'll come back with a survey for us?
Yeah, I can be on the agenda.
Okay.
Or just invite
We are making a decision. I mean, obviously the application has been... submitted, but we aren't going to make a decision on whether we do the paving or not tonight. I have a bunch of money stuff that are my own concerns about the road that I was going to share with Brian and Paul. But I'd like to get on to the school bid thing so Patrick doesn't have to sit too long through this. If you want to stay for that, you're more than welcome. Or you can catch it on TV.
Catch it on TV.
And Brandy, I had wanted to, was sort of assuming that you would be sitting in as a town treasurer, so maybe you and I could go over it later on this week, and just to get your take on, because it is a stretch. The cost to do it is a stretch. So, one that I, if it was my own personal money, I probably would... Stay with the dirt road.
We could turn it around and go that way up.
Well, then we're going to have people speeding through the village right by my house coming down the hill. I don't want that.
Yours is our,
No way.
Spikes. We got to put
spikes.
That's
actually the worst road around anyway.
Going past, just past Mike's, up through there.
Yeah.
That's brutal.
It's great. It slows people right down. I love it. All those potholes.
That's what's nice about the new roads.
Now you know how the people on Cabot Road feel.
Well, what happens oftentimes too is they're gaining speed going up the hill.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, so then it sort of, you know, flattens out and then they're on dirt.
And you know, in the wintertime, I think the big issue, I mean, it's the same issue we have on Valley Lake Road in the village where the pavement is and the dirt starts. You know, all winter there's salt and it melts and it runs into the dirt road. So it partially melts the frozen dirt road, and that's what helps make those potholes. Like in the village, like Valley Lake Road,
yeah,
I think at least four or five times the road crew has, there was like a curb of ice there. They've come down when it was warm and tried to scrape that down because it was quite a, you know,
well, that curb so fast, and all of a sudden it hit that dirt, their tires spin. So
right.
They hit that dirt and it starts that.
But you know, people that coming the other way, I watch them, they slow right down before they get to that spot. And then they, you know, then they go through the village.
Well, you hear them speeding up the hill, and as soon as they get to the dirt,
The village is the other place that we've looked at paving this year as well, from the fire station up to the school.
Yeah. That's a project that, you know, it's kind of, we've been talking about it. We need to solve the erosion issues there, and we've got other grants, and there's a whole kind of plan program for the village. This year we have a grant that hopefully we'll get through the Regional Planning Commission to do a full-scale design for fixing the erosion problems, and then hopefully next summer we would get another grant to do those projects to implement that, and then so the thinking is that next summer, if the work was going to happen, then that the end result would be that once that was all done, that section of road would get paved. And we would also pave, you know, if you look at the I call it the village street in front of the fire department and the town hall, that's just gone to hell this
winter. Pretty bad.
So we would try to do both at the same time.
Well, and so one question to that, the section of paved road on Cabot Road now, you mentioned that it's been about 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
What is the expectation of the maintenance on that in terms of having to repave it?
It's just wait and see how long it holds up.
So, but potentially the money that is currently held in this account for that went for paving, mm-hmm, on Cabot Road could theoretically be used for that.
That's
why it's there.
Yeah.
Okay. So if that money is gone and we require maintenance to that road, because it, mm-hmm, could potentially break, mm-hmm, down, and as, mm-hmm, you said, we're just kind of waiting and seeing when that happens,
right,
then who would then be on sort of the...
Well, what we need to do, I've been thinking about the paving fund, and the last few years, the only people contributing to it are Swenson Quarry. So if we were to do that project in the village, both bottom of Valley Lake Road and the street, I think that the town would need to contribute some money from the highway fund, general fund, and that would be something that we would request a town meeting so that we don't deplete that fund. And then I think the town should start putting in a chunk of money every year into that paving fund also.
That's for in front of the fire station.
For any of the roads that
the lower Cabot Road. Even.
You know, I mean, this road. These are not roads that technically the Swenson Quarry wants to compensate us for with our paving fund. You know,
well, but I would have to believe that the expectation from the people in the town would be that if paving needed to happen on the Cabot Road in the area,
yes,
that it is now, given that it's, you know, public knowledge that Swenson,
right,
gives money
they
towards that, that they would
too
use that money,
yes,
for that.
Yes, of course.
So that they wouldn't be on the hook for
repairs. When we repave that, you know, we'll keep an eye on it. It's been 3 or 4 years. It looks like it's in pretty good shape to me. So, you know, we'll start seeing cracks. Maybe we can seal the road, you know, for a while. I would anticipate when we need to repave that road that there'll be plenty of money in the paving fund. And plus we would be eligible for a V-Trans grant.
Mm.
For that one, yeah.
So it's an 80%, 20% match. So somewhere in my files I have the figures for that project. There goes our fire department. To, you know, the cost would be similar. I think we spent, town spent about $20,000 to repave that section of the road 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's not awful then.
It's not.
I was expecting it to be a lot worse than that.
Yeah.
No, when you get ready to pave in front of the 21 Valley Road, the town hall, the fire station, the post office section there, will 21 Valley Road be expected to help reimburse for that pavement?
What is 21 Valley Road?
It's where the store used to be, which is now an apartment building.
Right, that.
Which is commercial. And when we had the store, we had to kick in to help pay for that.
Well, technically that is a town, that all of that street is town owned. So no, I wouldn't be asking
you
them
got
to pay for it.
You got
Who made you pay for that? It wasn't us, was it?
Select board.
Really? I don't remember that. How long ago?
I wasn't on the
select
board.
Wasn't
me.
Wasn't me.
No, it wasn't you.
I must
Larry Rossi was on the board.
Okay.
Wow.
Okay. So, yeah, that's town property. According, Diana fished out the deed. They have parking rights there, but there's no parking spaces there that are basically owned by that building.
I think you should get your money back.
They have two spaces in front of the building.
They have been granted
the use of two spaces. No, in the original deed, they had two spaces in front of that building.
Right, but they don't own the street. They don't own the property, the land that the street is on.
And then you gave them permission to use two more slots.
We gave them, I asked you for permission for them to be able to park in front of the town hall for the winter plowing. Once the winter plowing, the snow season is over, there'll be two spots there and then they can park on the side of the building. They parked one car by their garage. So there were, and they needed space for four vehicles. So they used a space in front of the town hall, but I did get permission from you.
And you also asked permission so they could park behind the fire station that's on Valley Lake Road, which they never did. Sue had her car there.
That, I had nothing to do with any of that arrangement. I don't know when that was, who asked who for permission to park there. She's parked there forever.
Susan has, yes.
Yeah, and then when her catalytic converter got stolen, she parked in a different spot beside the annex building. But the select board had nothing to do with that arrangement that I know of. I don't know when that agreement was made, but it hasn't been made since
I've
been.
Whoever called me this fall, beginning of the winter, said we would like to use one spot in front of the town hall.
I called you.
And would it be possible if we could use another spot out back? The town would keep it plowed out.
I don't remember asking you that.
It's out behind the little annex building the fire department has?
Yes.
I don't remember asking you that.
Okay. All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hey, thank you guys.
All right. Sure.
Yep.
You all have a good night.
Stay tuned.
So we are going to talk a little bit more about the money tonight. It'll be in the minutes. You can watch it on TV if you want. Okay.
Now this is the hot seat over here. Now, who wants it next? Patrick, here we go.
Oh, man, I get it.
No falling asleep in it, though.
Possible. Good answer. Not when you get the tractor by Act 46.
So the next thing on the agenda is to open up the school bids. And I explained it earlier, but I'll explain it again.
Drop it down.
Tonight we're just going to open the bids and make note of who submitted the bids. And later on in the week, I'm going to meet with Larry Eldred to go over them. You're welcome to be there too, Patrick.
Let me know when that's happening.
Okay.
That'd be great.
Sometime Thursday or Friday, probably. And Skip, if you're here, you know, you're welcome to be there too, but it doesn't sound like you will be. And then what we'll do is I want to, with Larry's help, vet the two people that have submitted bids, make sure that they're up to the task. And then at the next select board meeting, we'll make a decision. I hope that as many people from the school board as want to be there.
That would be the 22nd?
Actually, it's not going to be the 22nd. We have to figure out what night we're going to meet.
Because the 22nd is...
22nd is another
school
meeting.
Event, yeah.
And I don't want to miss too many of them. So, give one to you.
Open up one.
Give one to you. Uh-huh. You can open them up. And you could just tell me who they're from. Don't tell me, I don't want to know the amount. just tell me who they're from. And I have an email from one person who emailed me saying that they weren't submitting a bid. Let's see if I can find that email.
I think that was Flanders.
Flanders, thank you. Yeah, it was Flanders. So there were six, I think there were six people that came to the site visit. So we've got two bids out of six.
Name of the bidder.
This is from an outfit called Watershed Construction and Restoration.
Okay.
A general manager named Brad Alexander.
Alright. Watershed Construction and Restoration?
Yep.
Okay.
This one is from Rod Roofing.
Rod Roofing, okay.
No surprise, yeah.
Right. Okay. So those are our two potential roof repairs. And, you know, for the next couple of days, the bids will be in the select board file. If you guys want to peek and look at the figures, you're more than welcome to. I'm going to.
There's only two of them, so it's not hard to peek.
Yep.
Wow. Just leave everybody in suspense.
Right. Okay. So yeah, so we'll put them back in the envelopes.
Okay.
I will you see that number here. On that one?
We'll hand them to Skip and he can peek too.
Skip, take a peek at it.
Whoa.
You wouldn't be any good playing Pokemon.
Fold. I'll pass that to Skip. Do you want to look at it?
Sure. Yeah, sure.
Let's see what he says.
Okay, we've done that. So moving on to the Woodbury Graded School Union District merger. Probably a month ago or so, we decided, I think it was kind of a joint decision between the school board and the select board to pursue a lease for the school. And there was a lease committee that was formed to just kind of try to basically to gather information for Paul Giuliani and Paul Gillis, the school district's lawyer and the town's lawyer, who were going to work together to put this lease together. And the lease committee did that, and then at the last lease, and then I think it was partly just there was a wave of discouragement about a lease that kind of flooded in, basically from a reaction to the lawyer from the supervisory union. And the lease committee at its last meeting, which was the end of March, we discussed lease versus conveyance. And we put together a list, and a pros and cons for both, which I believe everybody has received a copy of. And then, you know, so there was some rethinking with the lease. I met with Joanne LeBlanc last week to talk about that.
Did they come in tonight, Joanne LeBlanc?
No, that's Thursday's meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, and the cloud of doubt for the school district, for the select board, for the lease committee was that one of the school board members, Stephen Murphy, has been going to the is part of the committee that's been working on amendments to the Articles of Agreement, and there was a lot of flack from the other members of the new union district about Woodbury having the lease. So Stephen was
because everybody else is doing a sale.
Well. Conveyance, yeah.
Conveyance, yeah.
Except Lakeview Union, they use a couple of rooms in the town hall, so they are also lease arrangement.
Those, yeah.
But for us, it would be everything, you know, the school, the ground,
the property. Yeah.
So I don't know what the opinion was towards Lakeview, but Stephen was sharing with us that there's, you know, quite a bit of flack from the rest of the committee about. Allowing Woodbury to have a lease. Mm-hmm. So that's when we started thinking, well, you know, because the end result, the goal is to have the school continue as a school. Mm-hmm. So, you know, they're just thinking was, well, if this is what we have to do to have the school continue
as
a
school,
yeah. Then we would convey it with encumbrances, which would be with conditions on what would, you know, what would happen
down the road,
what would be done. But then the committee, the amendment committee, I'll call it, came up with, they, you know, through, I think, Stephen's skillful negotiating, basically they agreed that they would be okay with the lease, but not with the lease that we were initially looking at, which would be where the school district, the new Union District, the present Woodbury School District first, and then the new Union District would be totally responsible for the building, the capital repair, as it is and has been for who knows how many years. Mm-hmm. That basically that the lease would document in writing as a formal agreement that the school district has total responsibility for the building.
While they're leasing it.
While they're leasing it, yes. And that was objected to by the amendment committee. And they came up with kind of a proposal of their own, sort of, where the town would own the building, we would be responsible for the capital improvements, we would be responsible for any of the major, you know, physical building costs, and then the school, the new Union School District, would be responsible for the general maintenance and utilities, et cetera. Kind of like
the janitor and the lights.
Right, kind of like a landlord-tenant arrangement is what they were asking for.
So that's something that they would do.
Right. Well,
in a lease.
That's what's in the articles of agreement at the present time. Right now, tonight, there's a public hearing on those articles. There may be people raising objection to that, and so the way the thing is, this is another part of the unknown, is that right now that's in the articles of agreement, a lease agreement. However, you know, I don't know what the discussion will be like tonight, and once there is a public hearing, the people on that committee are hearing the comments, and then they'll take those comments and look again at the articles of agreement, and they might revise them based on the comments. And then at the April 22nd meeting, the first thing that happens is there's a floor vote to pick the new Union District representatives, and it will be and Patrick, please correct me.
No, you're doing good so far, Michael.
So this initial board will have equal representation from each town, two. Mm-hmm. And whether, I don't know if it's called a transition board or not, or
no, whatever. No, it is.
It'll be the board. So they'll be elected, and the first order of business that they're going to have that same night, April 22nd, is to approve and then warn the budget, and then approve and then warn the articles of agreement. So they could change them at that meeting. That's a possibility.
Actually, they're going to meet again on April 12th.
That's right.
And they may change them then to warn on the 22nd.
Yep.
But they have to be voted on by the electorate, so there will be an Australian ballot on the articles as well as the budget.
At that meeting?
And it won't, no. The budget meeting, I believe, is set for May 28th. I don't know if they've set a date yet for the articles.
My assumption is that they would both be at the
same
day. They would both be Australian ballot.
Yeah. They are both. Yeah. I don't know if they're the same day yet. But because you have to warn them, it probably is around the same time anyhow.
Yeah. So, you know, the articles of agreement could get shut down. And I'm not saying that the lease would be the reason why, but so it's not a done deal until it's all done. But I think, you know, from talking, and so the meeting on Thursday night, so just from what I've been hearing, different discussions, it seemed like this revised lease agreement, it does seem like it's acceptable to the supervisory union. It's not totally unacceptable to the people in the lease committee. Stephen Murphy has some concerns, but they're basically based on what happens if the lease gets booted out of the Articles of Agreement. He would like us to have a conveyance backup plan in case that happens.
He's running on short time to make all this stuff happen.
Well, that's it.
Yeah.
Well, but I'm not sure what the deadline is, because my reading of the original requirements from the state was that by June 30th, property had to be conveyed. Mm-hmm. Because that's when the new union district actually happens. Mm-hmm. So I think, generally, in terms of making a decision about conveyance, I think we have a little more time. I think the problem comes in around, so if you don't have basically an election on the articles until, say, the end of May, mm-hmm. and things go south, mm-hmm. then you've got very little time.
Right. And there are time constraints on conveying it also, which Skip has shared. I have it in my file here, but you know, because this is town-owned property, there would be a whole series of warning. It would be still the same kind of process.
I read that you sent out, and it seemed to me that the municipality can do it, but you have to go through a bunch of steps.
You do.
And if there's a petition, then you have to actually have a town meeting.
At a minimum, it's 30 days. The select board, in our case, the select board would have to post that they're wanting to convey that to the new union district.
Right. Right.
And if 5% of the voters in town object to that, then it sets off another 30 days where you would have public hearings and then a vote. Yeah. So it really can't happen.
It would be well beyond
instantaneously.
You know, I think it's prudent to move right along. But we don't know what the legislature is going to do about a delay either.
Right.
And it seems to me that if they're going to delay the eventual requirement to merge, then they're probably going to create some language around delays and some of the other requirements. It doesn't make sense to do everything else but not actually merge for another whole year.
Yeah.
So anyway, we don't know, so you got to proceed.
So right at the moment, I have to say, because the select board hasn't decided which way to go, which I was hoping we could do tonight, kind of pursuing this I'll call it an amended lease. I talked to Paul Giuliani today. He has written up a first draft, taking into consideration what the OSSU has shared with us and what the amendment committee has, created in the Articles of Agreement. A lease that would hopefully be for 3 years. And originally, we need to have the lease signed by the Woodbury School District while it still exists, so that in the Articles of Agreement, at least between the town and the school, Woodbury School District would have to be honored moving into the merger. So if we don't have that done by June 30th, then they could just say the new union district could say we don't want to deal with it. But if it's been signed.
So you guys are looking at 3 years. They initially said two.
Well, it's 3 years, basically. It's this year, this fiscal year, which will end June 30th.
Okay.
And then it's the 2 years that are in the Articles of Agreement to keep the school in existence.
Yes.
So it's basically 3 years, but not really. More like two.
3 years on paper, but two in a month. Yeah.
And that'll, let me finish my train of thought on that. So what we want to do is create a lease that isn't going to cause problems on June 30th for the new union district.
Right.
We want them to be on board with what we've done so that it will just gracefully continue.
And they've had a lawyer working on what they want on their end of it.
They've had a lawyer that kind of just crossed out everything that it was in the initial draft and presented their version. But yes, we will. Our two lawyers will have to work with that lawyer
fairly quickly.
Fairly quickly, yeah. We've been communicating with Joanne LeBlanc, who, as far as I'm concerned, she's the superintendent of the supervisor union, and she is in communication with whoever the lawyer is. And she is, you know, aware of what we're doing, and also has presented a scenario for a way for the lease to exist that would be acceptable. She's been going to all of the committee meetings for the Articles of Agreement. So she knows the general feeling of the new union, you know, that committee that's working on it. So this, and this lease would reflect that. And the other, you know, the other part of the lease and would be that this fiscal year 19, which will end June 30th, the reserve fund for the roof, half of that reserve fund would be paid to the town as rent. And then with the next fiscal year 20, which would start July 1st, the other half of that reserve fund would be paid to the town as rent. And therefore, we have the lease money, the reserve money to pay for most of the roof, or maybe all of the roof, to depend.
So once they get the building, there will be a...
They won't get the building. The town will own the building. We will be leasing
it. But they've been leasing, but they'll be paying us a lease payment every year? In the present wording
of this agreement, of this proposed agreement, the third year, the new union district would pay the town $1.
Okay, so this is just to clear out the...
Yeah, but that's not going to be reasonable. We're going to be paying insurance. There are going to be other costs. We need to figure out what the town costs are going to be owning that.
And they should absorb those, if nothing else.
They should be reflected in the rent. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we're going to have to, and that can, you know, we can do this agreement. The third year could be kind of up in the air. I think that's okay. I mean, Paul Giuliani, and the lawyers will figure that out. Because we, you know, it's going to take us a little bit of time to figure out insurance costs. You know, I talked to Passive today, but there's still some unknowns, and we have to see whether the new union district, you know, they'll be paying for liability. You know, we have to work out the whole insurance issue. We may find that there are other issues now that we own the building that we're, you know, that we would be eligible for, like mowing the lawn, the grounds. So, you know, so there's some unknowns that we need to figure out, but we have time to do that.
Yeah.
So,
we're lucky Larry's staying.
Is he staying?
I don't know. I hope so.
I heard he was retiring, but
I heard he wanted to. I didn't know if there's anything for sure. I think this would be his last year.
But he may have a continuing role, yet undefined.
Right. He's involved with the issues with the Lakeview Union School building as a kind of a consultant.
Oh, really?
Yes. So hopefully
the roof.
And the roof. He's going to be the basically.
And he's the project overseer for the roof. Yeah. So.
What about the water system? Because he's still.
Yeah, I think he was going to stay involved with that too. Mm-hmm.
Because I don't know he's anything the only about
certified
the
person
system.
We have.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I don't know any of these.
Oh, there has to be tests like.
Right. Yeah. Oh, right, for the new state requirement, right.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, I think he's going to stay on and do that.
Okay.
Yeah. The only issue I have with all of this, so we're going to meet Thursday night, joint meeting with the superintendent, right?
Yes.
And where?
Probably in the community. Do you think the school would be a better place?
No,
community. Okay, so the community room.
Six or better.
I was trying to ask.
What time?
6 p.m. is when the meeting starts.
Yeah.
And the idea would be to talk through whatever those issues are and at least identify the ones that are really
well. What I was hoping tonight was that the select board could agree on doing this lease. That was what I was going to advocate for, pursuing the lease arrangement. The lawyers are working on it right now.
Well, I would agree with you on pursuing the lease as long as that will work for Hardwick. Obviously, we don't want them to just shut us down
the purpose in doing this avenue for the lease is that it'll work for the town, it'll work for the new union district, and it will hopefully ensure that if there's a possibility the school will continue beyond the 2 years, that it will continue.
No chance.
And when you know, and there will be wording in this new lease for negotiating renewal of the lease, because that would have, that would happen after the 2 years. There would be negotiation to renew the lease, or the new union district would notify us that they want to terminate the lease.
Right.
Yeah.
That's what they always said right along. This is a 2 year deal, and then we'll see.
Yeah. Well, you're gonna have a new board. You're gonna have a new superintendent. There's a lot that's up in
there. Yeah, there'll be a lot of new. So,
so and, yes, actually,
and you know that would happen with conveyance too. There would be the issue after 2 years, if we did convey, there would be the still the same issue. Does the new union district want to continue the school as it is? So there have been, you know, in my discussion with Joanne, she never said anything explicitly, and I'm not going to say too much now, but you know, I got a feeling from talking with her that there is a possibility that Woodbury School would continue. It's kind of a wait and see thing, but there are things that are happening that she's aware of that actually maybe that school can benefit from.
If I can make one comment though, Michael, my concern for a number of weeks now has been if you convey the building, the school district owns it, they have to take care of everything. If you lease it, there's going to be some discussion, as Michael was saying earlier, about what does the school district pay for and what does the town pay for. And one of the sticking points was that I was hearing from various people that if the town owns it, the town's got to spend all the money to fix it and do all this good stuff. Right? So the roof becomes a responsibility of the town, which so far is fine. But we took a peek at the bids tonight, and one of them is well over the amount of money we have
in
the
reserve. Do you know how much is in that reserve fund?
About $90,000.
I was going to ask Brandy that tonight.
$90,000. Okay. And so if there's a balance, whether it's $10,000 or $20,000 or whatever the balance is, who's going to come up with that?
The town is going to have to come up with that money.
That's my understanding. That's based on the direction we're going.
Yeah. I think that's part of the unknowns, you know, and it would be really nice if we had more time to work out those unknowns before we do this, but it doesn't seem like it's a possibility. The town, you know, we may find that we're going to have to, that there'll be, I mean, there's going to be money that the town is going to have to cough up now to
If we want
to own the building, we're going to have to start paying for it in some way or shape, or you know.
And I'm just saying, it's more than insurance and mowing the lawn. It's going to be this one-time cost around the roof, whatever that could be.
Yeah.
So I just want that to be out in the open. I think that's a major.
I'm aware of that.
For a full-time position and an assistant janitor or whatever, we'll have to.
I don't think you should have to do that. Keeping the building clean and everything's a daily thing. It's part of the operation of the school.
That's general maintenance.
Where do you draw the line?
There's no objection to the new union district.
Basic operation of the school, daily and maintaining the building. So a roof is pretty obvious, right?
Yeah.
But I was raising the question of painting. If the building needed to be painted, which it will, is that maintenance or is that operation? You know, and Norm takes one position. But anyway, that's all got to get sorted out before.
It would be nice, you know, if we had another year, we could sort all this out and actually be able to present it at a town meeting or something so everybody could.
I just want to say for the record, Michael, I testified in the legislature
for
a delay for these very reasons, but I've been kind of stampeded.
And the people on the new union, you know, the people. The towns involved seem to want to get this thing done June 30th, so I don't understand that either. But here we are.
Here we are. So we'll probably, as a school board, we'll probably make a decision Thursday night when we meet about the conveyance or the
lease. You know, technically, it's up to the town.
Well, I know.
So, but yes, I would like to.
I mean, I think we should still go on record as to what we think is the right thing to do.
Now, could we be on the agenda to be there as a meeting?
It's going to be a special select board meeting.
Okay.
And it'll be a special
school board meeting too.
We could.
Does it ever happen?
Vote right there to.
We could wait and vote there, especially seeing how Paul is. I mean, I know how Paul thinks, but I shouldn't know. And I warned him that when he told me.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to you know, so maybe if it probably would be better that we wait.
Okay.
We could do that formally at the beginning.
And we'll know more.
And we'll know a little bit more.
Because the articles.
Yeah. The articles, they would have been.
Yeah.
It's going to be real opposition. You probably will know it, but.
Right.
Anyway.
Yeah, I don't anticipate that there will be.
I don't think so.
And with the, you know, if they make it through the new Union District Board, I don't think people who are voting on it would even know what the issues are to vote against.
Yeah,
I think they would have to vote on the whole thing, I think.
The package.
I don't know that either. That's another unknown.
Sure of
that. Yeah, I know. That's it. But that's the way it's been. We've been playing with all these unknowns that it makes it really hard to know how to move forward.
Uh-huh. So. Just got to bowl ahead and.
Well, what I would really like to see happen, I don't think it will happen, but the legislature wants this to move forward. They're adamant. But they're willing to extend the deadline. And so what I think would be the wisest course of action for all of us is for the new union board to be elected. Then you've committed to actually merging. But leave some of these other really tricky things, like even the budget. Why don't we're going to vote on a budget for the town.
Crazy.
And then we're going to vote on a budget for the new union. All this is kind of wacky to me. Why wouldn't we deal with the budget over the next year? We could do a better job, we could find efficiencies, blah, blah, blah. And why couldn't we deal with issues like this over the next year? Or at least
sometime. A few months out.
Yeah, exactly. You know, but
I agree.
Nobody listens to me anymore.
Well.
But anyway, I don't know what's going
to
happen.
The carrot for the other towns to want to do this immediately is the small school.
But see, I think we could make a deal with the state where we say, look, we've elected a board, we've set the following dates, and that should suffice to keep we've effectively merged as of June 30th. It's just that we approved budgets before the merger. So those budgets are going to be in place for the next year, and we'll come up, you know what I mean?
That seems
common sense to
sounds,
me.
Sounds much better to me.
We'll see. We'll see what happens tonight. We'll see what happens Thursday night. But basically, yeah, we don't have a lot of time left. No. Right.
We'll have a, Paul Giuliani has sent a revised draft, he sent it to me, to Patrick, to Norman, and did I send it to you? No. Who else did I send it to?
I can't remember either.
I can't remember either. It was a real whirlwind day. Anyway, there's a small group in town that's going to vet it, send comments back to the lawyer, and then we'll have a revised edition. Hopefully we'll have that by Wednesday so I can send it to everybody on the school board, everybody on the lease committee, everybody on the select board, so that we'll have at least a day to look at it before we get together Thursday night.
Yeah.
That's the plan.
Sounds good. Do you need me for anything else?
No.
All right. Well, thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Patrick.
You know, we're doing the best we can with what we got, aren't we?
Yeah.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Okay. Let's see. Let's do an easy one.
All right. You got one that's easy?
Yeah. Town official appointments.
Okay, I'm done.
Okay.
Hey, don't be leaving yet.
I got it.
Thanks for coming, Skip.
We need
and
people.
I'll be going. I'm in town till Thursday morning.
Okay.
So I'll be going to that Central Vermont Fiber meeting tomorrow night.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Good.
So
good.
I'll be going there.
Okay.
One thought. Health officer?
What?
I will send you the
incumbent.
I'll send you the draft that Paul
okay.
sent. And you know, either send comments to me, I'll send them on to him, or send them right directly to him.
Okay.
And then I'll send you what he comes up with for the Thursday night meeting.
In terms of splitting apart the maintenance of the building, we should be able to do that with Brandy's help.
Right.
Just look at the existing account or the budget that she has and split out the costs.
Like the other night when we had the Swenson Corey hearing in the community room, I noticed when we left that there was a lot of granite dust on the floor, and said, "Well, you know, who should pay for that? The school Or the town. It was a town meeting, and the room was, you know, kind of a mess from muddy feet coming in.
Sure. Yeah, so, community room. So, so who does pay for that? School?
I'm sure that Larry cleaned it up.
Yeah.
Larry or Don Church.
Yeah, or Don, right.
Yeah.
So anyway.
So I'll be around sporadically.
Okay. All right, well, good luck with everything you're dealing with. So,
Ethel, you want to get over here a little closer, or are you happy in the corner?
And then we'll do the town hall thing. Actually, we'll do the town hall thing so you don't have to sit here forever, too. In fact, why don't we do it right now? So, jumping around, I have the policy that we came up with recently somewhere in my folder or in this pile of paper. Where is it? Here it is. So, on the back, on the special conditions, consumption of alcoholic beverages in the town hall and parking lot is not allowed. Mm-hmm. So,
I think that came from VLCT when that happened.
Well, this actually Skip put this together, and it. I don't know. I think he looked at. There's an old policy, and I think that he did. There was something from VLCT that.
I remember doing that when I was on the board before.
You did it. We did it just this within this last year. You've been on again. Uh-huh. Yeah, this is it.
Yeah.
So there are a number of terms and conditions. No more. You know, I'm not going to go through all that. But and then special conditions. One of them is the consumption of alcohol. So, you know, it's a policy, it's not an ordinance, it's not a state statute, so we can grant a, we'll call it a waiver.
Mm-hmm. I can tell you one thing that I've heard of other places, like, you know, venues, that when they allow alcohol, they have to have a certified bartender there on site to do
that. That's what I've heard, too.
Yeah, yep. So you got to pay that guy, and he's responsible for not over-serving people, so that's one of the things that people do.
He would be responsible for getting all the alcohol in there. Right. An individual like me or you couldn't bring in our...
When is this party wanting to use the town hall?
May...
So we have some time.
11th.
Yeah. You think that they would go to that extent to hire a bartender?
I know, I'd have to get back in touch with
her. I think what I could do is, that's one of the things I wanted to know. Well, is it just going to be... beer and wine and coolers and people helping themselves. Mm-hmm. Are they going to have an open bar, kind of like a cash bar or whatever?
I know other venues have dealt with it, and that's how they've come up with is to make somebody responsible for it rather than...
Yeah, I could contact VLCT to see if they probably do have some kind of, you know, waiver wording or whatever, if it's called a waiver, but,
this is what you got to do if you want to
If
have
this is going to happen, this is what, because it's, for the town, it's a liability issue.
Right.
Obviously.
Yep.
So, and we have to be careful, we have to cover the town for that, and so if we're going to make a condition that this is allowable, we'll have to have more, amendment to the policy, or an addition to the policy.
Right.
Yeah. They may have something down there already.
I bet they do. I would think they would.
That they could send us. Because somebody's got to take responsibility if somebody gets drunk and falls down. And it really shouldn't be the town.
And then,
accepting
people driving away. I guess once you're on the state highway, that's not the town's problem. But
bartender's problem if he was over-serving.
If there is a bartender, if it's help yourself from a cooler, that could be
that's the difference. Yeah, and that may be the difference in this. That's why they've gone to making... Yeah. Somebody accountable.
Yeah, so it may be that, we'll find out. So I will contact VLCT and find out if maybe we should just do that first rather than trying to, is it early May or late May?
The
11th. The 11th, okay. Oh, I'm sorry, I wrote that down. So that's not that far away, actually.
Right.
It's a month away.
No.
So I'll contact VLCT this week, and I will let everybody know what I hear from them, and...
Because if it's just conditions, it's probably they've got a sheet right down there
sheet,
they can mail us that we could just pass right out.
Yeah, we could add that to the policy. We could do that officially at our next select board meeting, and then send it on.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably the plan that we'll
We're meeting Thursday. Official meeting.
I have
no agenda items there. Yeah, but.
That'll be just one topic only. Plus, I won't have time really probably until Thursday to call VLCT. At least time when they're there to answer the phone. So. Okay, so that's how we'll address that, I guess.
Okay.
So back to town official appointments. So the folks that were on the Sylvia Jackson Fund got back in touch with Mary, who is sort of the chair of that committee, the Sylvia Jackson Committee, and they all indicated that they would be willing to stay on as members of that committee.
Okay.
So I would make a motion that we appoint Mary Gangemi, Susan Martin, and Jeff Thompson to the Sylvia Jackson Fund Committee.
Second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So they'll be appointed.
Yeah.
And then I have health officer on here. I haven't been, and it's mostly my fault, I haven't been able to have a conversation with Heather Lanfear about this, and I haven't also really had the time to connect with the town manager in Hardwick to see
if they have one that they could share. Or?
Right. So I haven't done my homework on that. And you know, I want Heather to know what the responsibilities are, in particular with the, you know, any kind of citations that she
for
might
enforcement,
be,
yeah.
Yeah, for enforcement.
Bottom bare minimum, she needs to come in and talk to us so that we can.
Right. There is a at the end of April. There's a day long VLCT workshop on health officer issues.
Yeah.
So I would hope that if she did want to do it, that she would be willing to do that.
Yeah.
Because the town would pay.
Yeah.
For that.
Yeah, that'd be really good to go to first before we appointed anybody.
Yeah. And I have sent her some information. There's a 100-something-plus page book on health officer stuff, which I think you've seen. There is a question of whether or not, I have an old email address for her, whether or not she actually got that.
If that hasn't scared her off, then she hasn't read it.
So, you know, I haven't spoken with her directly. I've been kind of, Laura Daly has been.
Yeah.
Speaking with her.
So, have you posted it anywhere else? Woodbury Connections, from Fort Fortrum, anything that we're looking for?
No, I haven't.
Just to see if anybody else, maybe we could get two or three people sucked in.
I haven't done that. So, but could do that. I could put it on the town website and Front Porch Forum and see if
there's maybe there's somebody else out there already that's had experience doing it that enjoys it.
So, and that's pretty much it. I still haven't heard anything from about the rail trail committee. So
nope, I haven't talked to any of those guys yet.
So that's another one that we need to see
who's
make appointments for. So, so you and I could go over these figures for the paving if you want. I mean, it might be good just to...
For the paving as far as the Cabot Road?
Yeah, just the money situation with it.
At this point, I'd just wait a little bit just to see if any other people come in, because, you know, it would definitely be a great project, but if everybody on the Hill
people
doesn't
to
want
it... Yeah, I don't want to...
And so it's not the trucks that they're objecting to, it'd be the vehicle traffic, the cars and pickup trucks that are going to speed up and down the hill. So I'd really like to hear from those others maybe at our next meeting.
Okay.
And Mark and Karen and Wayne and...
And I can contact the Regional Planning Commission. They're the ones that put out the money. I'll look in the data that we have already from a few years ago. I think that part of the Cabot Road was done, but I just can't remember because it was too long ago.
So you do think they did some of it at least?
I think they might have done the very bottom part where it's paved.
Just I almost remember seeing one at Flat Street.
Yeah.
So just before it goes on to the dirt.
But they would be glad to come and maybe once the snow is gone,
Do it again.
Do it again and do it in two or three different spots on the hill.
So if you were living on the hill again, would you want it paved clear to the top?
It would have some advantages to it.
It definitely would, yeah. That's why it amazes me so many people are against it. But yeah, it's a good solid road the way it is. The trucks have been using it. If they're not turning into the quarry, that eliminates one of those spots where they're trying to turn off of, you know, ice onto another road.
When we looked at that, when the person came who gave us the estimate, when he came, I wanted him to know that we were wanting an estimate for up to the Fletcher Quarry Road and then up to the new proposed access road.
Yeah.
And Greg Parkhurst was with me that day, and this guy is, he's kind of the regional rep for a large paving company in Vermont, New England, who we all know the name of, but I'm not going to mention. And both he and Greg said, if you're going to pave it up to the Fletcher Quarry Road, you're going to have real troubles with anybody going up that hill who hits the pavement on that steep upgrade and gets onto, snow, dirt, dirt road.
So if you only paved it up halfway, it'd be bad.
It would be bad.
Yeah. So you have to do the whole thing.
Mostly it would be bad because it ends at a slope is pretty steep.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And we see what happens at the end of pavement. We see it at your place. We see it in Woodbury. Right. Where it ends, you always get this huge berm because the salt that gets traveled up there.
Yeah. So people would be hitting that berm.
Yeah.
So
you either almost got to go either to the top.
Yeah. Although the salt
or not.
The salt would actually be running downhill, so maybe it wouldn't affect.
Well, they'd be carrying it on their tires.
Right. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, there would probably be problems. But they just say, oh, this is they just threw out the red flag. This is not a good idea. So.
But that might free up money to. Up past your place a little bit. Just get them speed up a little bit through town.
Right.
That road is horrible.
I know there are people in town that, now complain about how fast people go through town.
And you can't cure everything.
What can you do?
So we have two possibilities.
So tell me it wasn't my house.
No, it was the lady that, very last house in Woodbury. That one that's about a quarter mile out in the woods.
Oh, okay.
Yep. That was a real joy going down her driveway. But her heater filled her house up with smoke. Luckily the house wasn't on fire.
Yeah.
So while you were away, we went over the school. So just for the record, now that you're here, we talked about the lease and the conveyance.
Yep.
Patrick was here, Skip was here, Brian and I are sort of in favor of a lease.
As am I.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, so that's kind of what I...
Is that what's his recommendation too?
I
know it's a complicated issue, but...
It's a complicated issue, and we originally decided on, I'm kind of giving you a quick synopsis here. We had originally decided on a lease, and there was a lease committee formed, and we started working on getting information to the school district lawyer and the town lawyer, who were working together on forming a lease. But meanwhile, one of the school board members has been part of the amendments to the articles of agreement for the merger for the new union district, and he was getting a lot of flack from the other town members about a lease. So it created a sense of doubt within the lease committee about, well, maybe this isn't the way to go. Maybe we should be talking more about conveyance if they aren't going to accept a lease. So we did that. We discussed it. I believe I sent the notes of lease versus conveyance.
I have all that stuff. I've read through some of it.
Yeah. Yeah. But then the committee that's working on the amendments to the Articles of Agreement kind of softened on the lease. They inserted the lease agreement into the proposed amended articles. and also came up with terms for the way that they would accept the lease, which basically would be that it would be more of a landlord-tenant arrangement where the town would be responsible for, you know, capital improvements and major repairs on the physical building, and then the school district would take on the responsibility for general maintenance and stuff like that, and, you know.
Well, like a landlord rental.
Yeah, like a landlord, like landlord-tenant arrangement. That's basically what we would be studying up.
And if they're good with that, you know, it doesn't matter to me either way. It just, it's nice to see it get used for 2 years. I don't want to be a stumbling block where they say, no, forget it, we're done. We're just going to take the kids out and leave.
Right, yeah. I mean, that's what's kind of leaning toward whatever the committee has been working on this.
Right, yeah. And that was kind of what the feeling was, well, maybe, you know, because they can do that.
Yeah.
If we present a lease to them, you know, the initial thinking was to come up with a lease between the school district and the town, the Woodbury school
district. Get it done before.
Get it done before June 30th. Yep. So, and then because in the articles of agreement, the wording goes that any contract arrangement that's been set up prior to June 30th, would have to be honored for 2 years by the. You know, part of the feedback that we were getting is that if you go with a lease that where the new union district is totally responsible for everything, capital improvements, you know, everything, like this Woodbury school district has been, you know, since who knows when, chances are that they would probably just say, okay, we're just going to bust this kids to Hardwick.
Yeah.
So that was the fear.
Okay, so there's no, we didn't need to make a decision on it then, it was just a...
Well, that's what we need to make, and you know, making a decision on whether or not to go with this, I'm calling it kind of a revised lease that the lawyers are actually working on right now.
So that'd be our next meeting. We'd actually
we could make that decision at the very beginning of the next meeting, or we could make it tonight. I mean,
basically, we don't actually have it in our hand is the issue.
That's it, right? We don't have it in our hands.
So there's a meeting Thursday night at the community room.
Right.
Is that going to be deciding on the lease stuff, or what are they going to be doing there?
Yes, and we would be dealing.
And that's a co-meeting. I guess we're going to be there too as well, Paul.
The select.
Can you make that Thursday
if you
night?
Can make it.
I think so. I don't have anything that I know.
If you can't, and I know how you feel about it, that would.
Yeah, I mean,
that too. But
the lease is attractive. I don't want to be voting against what the people doing the work.
Right.
Are recommending. And that's where my
and the downside of conveyance, the major downside is that the town no longer owns the building. And we have no say over how,
which I don't like that idea.
Yeah, how it's going to be maintained, blah blah blah. You know, if we conveyed it and they decided to keep the school going for a number of years, you know, if we had done that, we would have no control over the physical quality of that building.
Because my preference is that we own the building,
right?
If that ends up being closed,
right.
that doesn't become an asset of the combined district.
Right. Yeah. And so, actually, in the articles of agreement, if they did decide to close the building, there's a one of the articles is that it would be conveyed back to the town.
Okay.
Originally there were conditions
on
that, which some of those conditions have been struck in the amended articles.
Because there was often talked about potential for a supervisor union to maybe come out and put some
And in the conveyance.
We'd rather be landlords because we collect rent.
Right, in the lease or in the conveyance, either way we had gone, there would have been conditions for, you know, if they close down the school to, as far as educating children, but want to move all their offices in there, you know, there would have been an encumbrance in there that the town
changes the relationship quite a bit.
Would not agree to that.
Yeah, because I'd rather, if that's the circumstance, I'd rather maybe the landlord and they got to pay a monthly.
Right.
Because we got a lot of exposure.
Because the other side of that is, that would be the biggest business in town.
Yeah.
Right.
It wouldn't be bad for them.
It wouldn't be bad. No,
right.
Agreed.
No. Right.
But we want some, because my fear with the new district is we're a small party in it, and we're not going to have a lot of say once this happens.
Yeah.
So we need to leverage whatever our position is now to our best position for the town.
Right. I know at this hearing tonight, they're going to be hearing about the the way the articles are set up for representation, there are a lot of people in town that
we're going to have,
and a lot of I assume in Greensboro and Standard too, that that really don't like the dominance of Hardwick on, on the board.
But I can also see their side that they're
that's probably the way Hayes
two thirds of the people. Why do you get a two? You know, I get both sides.
You can't be even when you've got, you know,
they have.
So again, our best position is to leverage this. We're in a stronger position now. Leverage as best we can now.
Right.
Yeah. Don't give up now. You know, play hardball now.
Right. So I can. There was. I spoke to Paul Giuliani, who is the main writer of the lease. You know, he's working, and he's been hired by the school district. He's working with our town lawyer, Paul Gillis. But basically, Paul Giuliani is the writer of this. He has more expertise in real estate and education issues. So, but Paul Gillis is definitely okaying what he's doing and adding comments. So Paul Giuliani sent a rough first draft of a revised thing. I'll send it to you guys. We're going to send comments back to him, hopefully tomorrow, Wednesday at the latest. So what I would like to, he would like to be able to hear comments. So, you know, earlier this afternoon I sent his first draft to Patrick and to Norman Etkin, who's been working very closely with both the school district and the town on this, because he has a lot of knowledge. And and I sent it, can't remember who else, I sent it to one other person, but I can't remember who it was. Anyway, so they're going to be sending comments back. I'm glad to send it to you guys if you want to, you know, have, it's not a long, it's, you know, it's only about 3 pages.
Yeah, that'd be fine.
And if there's anything, comments that you have, maybe send them to me, and then I can send
as a one unit
one thing, and I could send it to Paul. If you could do that before tomorrow evening, that would be great.
I should have time unless they send me somewhere weird tomorrow.
I won't have time. It's a full day of work for me tomorrow, and then I have a regional planning commission meeting in the evening, so I probably won't look at it until first thing in the morning.
Yeah, I'm scheduled for an office day, but and then I got a gate fire warden meeting tomorrow night, but if they don't send me somewhere.
So the hope is that Paul Giuliani can look at the comments, make any other revisions that he wants, get that back to us on Wednesday sometime, so that can send it out to everybody on the school board, to select board, and people that have been involved in the lease committee, so that everybody has at least some time to look at it before Thursday
evening. Before Thursday night, yeah.
And then Thursday evening, I'm going to warn it as a special select board meeting. I think the school board is going to also warn it as a special meeting.
It covers our bases.
Our bases, and so there'll be the select board. Sounds like we'll all be there, which is great. There'll be the school board, as many as can be there.
What time is that again?
6 o'clock is when it'll start.
In the community room.
Yeah. And there'll be people that have been on the lease committee. The only people that are involved beyond the select board are Norman. And Brad had been the ones that are most involved. Skip and Brandy came to the initial meeting. Brandy hasn't been since, and Skip hasn't been able to either. Because of his family commitments.
Yeah.
So they'll be there. Joanne LeBlanc, the superintendent of the supervisor union, will also be there. So the first thing that we'll do, and I'm just thinking off the top of my head now, is the first thing we'll do is formally approve going the lease route. I mean, we could do that tonight. It's basically up to us to do that, but it would be nice to have the school board there also.
That's what the school board wants to do.
That's what we had talked about doing, and you know, other people have been telling me, no, it's the town property, it's up to the select board to do that. The school board doesn't have a say in that.
But they're the ones that have been involved.
They've been involved
directly this whole time.
I'm nervous without their input.
My feeling is just out of courtesy.
Because we could make do the vote Thursday night.
Yes, that's what I would like to do, but I don't want it to take up too much time in the beginning. And I know the one angel on my shoulder that's been advising me that it should be just about working on the lease will be mad at me to change that. But I agree. It feels better to me that we, you know, I'll just present that the select board feels that we should go this way. Are there any, sorry, my throat is drying out from talking too much. Is there any real strong objections from the school board, and what are they? And then just have people do a show of hands.
Yep.
A glass of water somewhere.
Yeah,
there's one right around the corner behind us here.
This is before you dry up and blow dust.
Yeah, that meeting Thursday night is open to the public?
Yep.
I think so,
yes,
yeah.
It'll be a warm meeting. So yes, it is open to the public. And
these
the main,
papers go with that, they weren't for me, right?
That's the school, the two roofs.
On the roof.
Yeah. Okay.
You can look at them.
Yes, but there won't be, I mean, it's totally focused on, hang on a second.
Get a drink, we don't need your coffee.
The meeting is, the purpose of the meeting is to come up with the terms for the lease.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not really gonna be encouraging a lot of public debate.
Yeah.
I mean, the time for that would have been tonight, actually.
Right.
So if you do have any thoughts about it, you know, you can come and share them. We're going to just have a very brief time in the beginning, sounds. If you have anything that you'd
for
like to share now, you're welcome to do that. Okay. But yeah, it is open to the public. It's publicly known. So.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, so that's pretty much
okay.
It. Pretty much it. Okay. And then, you know, where you were here for a lot of the paving talk, and so
yes.
we just before you came in, we briefly talked about that. We're going to.
That's why I came back. I wanted to share my view on it.
Yeah.
I didn't hear yours yet.
Okay. So yeah, if you have some comments about that, what we had kind of come up with is that we're going to sort of put the brakes on it.
That's what I was going to say. I think we should push pause button because I, having thought about it, this is all valid stuff to look at. However,
yep.
If it was the permit, then you're still going to have to deal with these issues. So
yep.
They don't weigh a lot to me.
Mm-hmm.
The bigger issue I see is we're really strapping ourselves financially.
We are. And
because we're taking a big chunk of that paving money, we're committing to 10, 12 years of it.
It's even more convoluted than that.
Well, and more salt. And I just, it's
yeah,
not a good
yeah.
deal. For
yeah.
us, and
yeah,
I don't see
I
what we're getting.
We're doing the quarry a favor. That's basically what we're
and
doing.
It's going to
yeah.
cost us, and we're going to pay for it along. I've had more time to think about it, and without hearing these comments, and I'm
right.
like, oh.
If I expected them to take more stone off the mountain, which would increase their volume,
right.
but it doesn't sound like they're talking that there's going to be any more stone coming
so
off.
I gave you guys copies of this. You know, look at it if you want. I was going to talk through it because, you know, it might be kind of confusing to look at it, but it would really be a stretch.
Oh, yeah, I started thinking
that.
About it, and I was like,
I
we're
mean,
not going to have this money coming in, and then we're going to be
right.
expending a lot more on
yeah.
maintenance.
We would, Swenson, you know, well, I don't want to get into it, but take a look at this. If we want to talk about it more, at our next select board meeting.
You sent us a copy of this.
I didn't send it.
Okay,
I made copies
yeah.
and I handed you each one. It's probably in your pile of paper somewhere, but I can make
yeah,
some copies before
yeah.
I go.
I didn't give it. I don't think you gave it to us.
Oh, maybe I just made them and didn't give them to you. I remember handing
you're good as my am.
Well, that's the thing, you know, you get these piles of paper. I'm pretty sure I gave them to you guys.
Yeah,
and the other thing that.
Did you
that,
take them off the copier?
Yes, I did take them.
The other thing that kind of weighs on me is like, think we'd be making a mistake not letting the townspeople weigh in on a decision
right.
like
I
that
agree.
And having rethought if
that's,
I lived on the road
that's what we did
I'd
tonight.
Like to be asked you
yeah.
know so
they're going to go survey the
yeah.
rest of the people up on the hill and
yeah
see
they're
going
to go talk to people
yeah.
They're more concerned about people speeding on
yeah.
paved roads
so
and I get that again some of these issues
and we're going to monitor the road I think we might have done
yeah.
just the very bottom of the road a few years ago we'll this summer we'll do via Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission to monitor road and if there you know, see if there is a speeding issue
yeah.
and
then Swenson's not doing their thing. It'll be this summer sometime.
This summer is when they want to do the road.
There's time, and we may be in a better position to have them participate more if that ever comes to happen. To say, we just don't have the money. We can't commit that much money to
that far away.
You guys want it.
And the only time it's an issue for them, really, is during mud season.
Yeah.
So, in the end, it may be better off not to.
Yeah.
I'll make copies of this. Before we leave.
Seems like we all had the same kind of thought process after we left last time.
Yeah, but it is,
thinking about the dollars, and I'm like,
I've spent a couple 2-hour sessions just going over the figures, and it's sort of doable, but it would be a real stretch.
It's a stretch.
And then it stretches us out.
We've got other areas that need work that
we're
committing past those years,
yep.
The town parking lot, yep. The other Valley Lake Road, things mm-hmm. that we really do need to do
yep.
that benefit us.
Yep. Okay, so what else? So we also appointed people to the Sylvia Jackson Fund, Mary Gajemi, Susan Martin, and Jeff Thompson. We talked briefly with Robin about the alcohol use at the town hall. There's somebody that would like to serve alcohol. I'm going to contact VLCT.
What's your feeling on that?
I mean, it is a big liability.
Yeah. I can tell you my opinion. I'm not a big fan of allowing alcohol at town. It's strictly prohibited at the firehouse mm-hmm. and around fire. We don't even allow it at a fire department picnic unless it's at mm-hmm. an off-campus.
Yeah.
Too much liability.
Yeah. Well, I'll see what VLCT has to say about it. I mean, they would also be very concerned about that.
Oh, yeah. It's a lot because we used to do it, and sometimes not so nice things happen. So.
Yeah. Yeah, so we'll look at what VLCT. We're thinking that they probably have a whole policy already written up.
Yeah.
So we'll look at that at our next meeting, and we'll make a decision whether or not to do that. And we can decide not to, even with whatever the terms are. And
when alcohol will go right to VFW work.
Right.
So,
yeah. I think that's. There's one other, So, a very short road crew report. The roads have been amazingly good so far, and they are.
They're just wet right now. Nothing
they're just wet.
Really do. It was horrible, but it's.
Yeah, it's going to rain all week.
Yeah,
but
dry out.
They are kind of amazingly dry. They brought some gravel up to West Woodbury and dumped a little bit of gravel here and there, but there isn't anywhere near the kind of mud rut pits that there have been in the past, and Greg is thinking that once we get past this rainy spell, if we get some dry weather, that the road should dry up pretty nicely, and they'll start grading right off. They have done a little bit of grading,
because it's pretty washboardy up on the Cabot Road right now. Right before you get to where they want to put that new entrance,
dry.
Yeah,
it's a little wet, but it's really washboardy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So they definitely are ready to be graded.
Yeah, some of them are for sure.
Yeah, and then the low pro, the wing blade on the low pro started torquing. It's actually bending.
It's under warranty still.
It's under warranty. Yeah. So one of the times I was there, the road crew kind of pointed out to me that you look at the other wing plow blades and they're really pretty substantially reinforced, and the new wing plow blade on the low pro is much less so. So they brought it to Viking, they looked at it, they're going to, they'll take it later on this summer, and they're going to pretty much revamp it for under warranty.
Their cost, okay.
Yeah, so. But, otherwise, things are fine. Equipment is all
ready to go.
Yeah, ready to go. And then one other, on the adjustments to the agenda, I just wanted to...
I had a road crew issue. Yeah, just a quick one. It's just a concept to talk about.
Okay.
Looking back at the...
The road crew inventory?
Yeah. I don't know the best way to talk to Greg about it, but it looked like a lot of those problem areas could be fixed with the grading those edges in. I'm not an expert on road.
Yeah.
I think we should give the direction to them.
Mm-hmm.
That whatever roads they're grading, when it comes to dry enough to do it. I mean, I realize there's going to be times where you're spot grading and you've got to get everybody happy, but when you go to do your real grading,
mm-hmm.
that they make sure that they take care of the
right.
that when they can clean culvert ends out. And I think we need to actually give them that direction,
because mm-hmm.
because I know it wasn't happening last year, so.
Right.
And maybe have some interaction with Greg on that.
Yeah.
I'm not a road maintenance expert. He may have reasons why you couldn't and couldn't. But
yeah,
as I said the last meeting, yeah. As you know, when you, those are leveraging the money we're already spending, and it kind of segues into the discussion with Brian on the third road person. I think
right.
There's enough work where someone's going to need to get out of a truck, clean the ends of the culverts out, because you know if you don't clean those ends, they'll never, those
right.
type of things. And yeah, so right. to me, that's a benefit. If we're going to pay for that third person, then we just
right.
give that direction. Say, when you grade a piece of road, the expectation you're going to roll those edges in, even if you have to scoop up the material and
right.
haul it away,
yeah.
and crown it the best you can with the material that's there,
mm-hmm.
clean your culvert ends, and then move on.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? I mean, that's all I was
yeah.
going to suggest, because that's maximizing
mm-hmm.
the amount of money we're spending
mm-hmm.
in fixing this list, which I think we have 5 years to take care of this.
We have 5 years to fix the high priority.
Right, so a lot of those, remember, most of them were edges, you know, high
well, edges. Actually, all of the high priority ones are more, probably the crown and the berm is,
crowns
is,
and berms,
is a
yeah.
part of it, but those are all more erosion issues.
Sure, but we can
yeah.
address them, is what
yeah.
I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's with the money we already spent on road maintenance.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, I'm
yeah.
not an expert, willing to talk to Greg, and, you know,
yeah.
just,
yeah.
you
yeah.
know,
yeah, sir.
He can
more
educate
okay,
me,
yeah.
but as I'm saying, as you're on a piece of road, roll those edges in.
Right, yeah.
Crown it properly.
And when I met with the Regional Planning Commission going over this inventory report, I asked for a training this summer for road crews about the crowns and the berms.
Yeah.
And they're going to try to facilitate that. And hopefully if it happens, everybody on the road crew will go to it just
yeah.
so that they all...
Yeah, and that was the next thing too is we've got the extra two employees that... They work on getting all of those employees time on all the equipment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
because you're investing money to make sure everybody
yeah.
gets on the grader, everybody
yeah.
gets on the excavator, so that we,
yeah.
if you have someone transition out, you don't have, well, this person can't run the grader. It's like, why?
Right, right.
Yeah,
yeah, no, that's been happening.
And I'm new to this, so I assume it's our kind of position to kind of give that kind of direction.
Yeah.
It should be.
Yeah.
It should be, I think.
There's kind of a little disconnect. Yeah, because we always had the road foreman come to the meeting.
Yeah, that's
Greg
that's
has stopped, and it's been a disconnect, as far as I'm concerned,
right.
between the select board and the road crew, because
right.
you're the only one that meets with them.
I'm kind of
you're
the
really I'm not picking on anybody
but,
either.
No,
it's
yeah.
just
yeah.
I know that the biggest complaints that I myself personally had, or you're probably getting, is just
mm-hmm.
maintenance complaints.
Right.
And so, us giving direction.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think says
right.
that, like, there shouldn't
right.
be anybody that has a really bad road for a long period of time needs
right.
to get out there and get fixed. So, because
yeah.
I just don't want my phone lit up.
Right.
Which you probably get.
Yeah, when I get calls
complaints.
Or, you know, calls go to the garage or they come to me or you guys get them.
Yeah.
You know, and the road crew responds to,
yeah.
to those when they come in.
Yeah.
Because
we got, you know, we got future issues like the brush cutting and just things, I think, really
right.
easy for us to write up a one sheet that just says
mm-hmm.
our expectation is that when you grade the road,
mm-hmm.
you'll clean the culvert ends, you'll
right.
You'll roll the
yeah.
edges in, even
mm-hmm.
if it means cleaning all that material being picked up with a bucket loader and hauled away,
right. yeah.
just to get that lip off so the ditch opens up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, crown it as best you can. I realize the road might need some gravel, but
mm-hmm.
you don't have gravel today. Let's get it crowned the best
right.
we can now.
Like last year with the Grants and Aid, with doing the Foster Hill, they actually cleaned up the berms with the bucket loader.
Right, right. And they need to do that on every road because I think you're going to be on all those roads a few times this coming year. So
yeah.
Something we saw that I think I've seen over the years is with all the new grants that they keep getting to do
mm-hmm.
projects,
mm-hmm.
they're doing less road maintenance.
Happens, right, because you get focused on
yeah.
one area.
Yeah, the thing, you know, all the grants now, the Better Roads grants, you know, which used to be kind of anything that needed to be done, are now all focused on the Act 40.
Water.
Yeah, the Act 64.
Yeah, so sometimes
water.
You're spending so much time
in
running around
spot.
Doing
right.
doing the little, we got some
right.
money to do this
right.
spot, we'll do that spot.
Yeah.
Then some of the other places.
Well, I know that Greg is aware of the conditions of the road, so, it, you know, that's not totally true, you know, the roads.
But if you're doing the project over here,
right.
you're not
yeah.
grading.
But
over
again,
there.
For us,
right.
I think
it's tough,
we
yeah.
should just give the direction, and we can just write
right.
up. That's my feeling of it. Is just because I don't like to blame an employee when they don't do what you ask them to do if you didn't
right.
ask them to do it,
right?
Right.
Yeah.
basically just say, here's the expectation. If you have a problem, come talk to us about it. And this would be a great meeting.
Yeah. Maybe even once a month or something, we get together as a group and take a ride around.
Yeah, because I'm even willing to go in.
But we have to warn it.
We'd have to warn it.
No, but like not knowing a lot of what they do, it's easy to pick on it. But I'm more than happy to go sit with them for a day.
You're more than welcome.
That's what I'm saying. So I might actually do that.
You should.
For education purposes.
Yeah.
Watch them do a project.
Yeah, because I know what it's like to be criticized and not everybody has appreciation for what you do. So I don't want to be that guy. But on the other hand, sometimes you've got to have some direction.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the road crew, if the intentions are stated to them that they...
This is what we need done.
They would live up to them.
Yeah, so. I think so too. Yeah. Good. And I think that addresses some of that third person thing too.
Yeah.
Because I think there's plenty of work.
Mm-hmm. There is plenty of work.
If you just change it, you know, if you don't just send the grader over, you're going to have to send the grader, a dump truck, and a bucket loader. Because once he rolls those, because the edges I know where I see are all sticks and leaves and that material when it comes up, it's all going to have to be hauled away. Right. As long as you've got that program going, you just got the guy with the loader, the guy with the truck, and the road's ready to grade. Yeah.
And at some point, you know, the select board does need to have a discussion about a third full-time person, you know, because we are, you know, I feel in a way that, you know, we're basically taking advantage of our two part-time workers right now. I don't know if they want more work or not, but I do want to have that discussion with them this spring, actually. I have an intended to do that. Previously, you know, we had two older men who were retired, and this was kind of a supplemental income for them. But now we have two younger men who, you know, are kind of piecemealing together earning
jobs
in order to.
Yeah.
And so it's not fair to, you know, in my opinion, I mean, I feel we're basically getting the better end of the deal, and in a way, sort of taking advantage.
Yeah. Well, we're training two guys right now, so we can figure out.
Yeah.
You know?
And the thing that bothers me about that is that, you know, obviously maybe they would both want the full-time job, and then we have to decide who's going to get
between
it.
And that can just be a competitive process. And that's why I think it's important that we fairly get people trained on each. Because if one gets the grader and doesn't, the other one does it, then you're going to say, well, this guy Rose knows how to use it, let's hire him, while the other guy didn't get. And in fairness, I think as part-time, they should both get.
Right.
All the same training.
So that you get your best choice.
Okay. Well, that's something down the road here, probably.
As far as coming up with that list, I'll write something and bring it in. There's a little bit of time because proper road maintenance isn't going to happen for another few weeks.
Right. And so, right at the moment, with that inventory, we have to come up with a 5-year plan for the high priority sites, and we have to do
this would address those medium sites, I think.
Right. Yeah.
Because that's the one that just stuck out.
There's a lot.
Like, wow, that's easy to fix.
Yeah.
There's a lot. So you attack what's easy to fix initially.
Yeah.
At low cost.
Look on the digital map. You can.
I've got it on the computer.
I'll bring down the. You know, it's too bad they make the map so big. There's no place.
Right. You can't. You need a whole building wall to put it.
Maybe I'll try to bring that down because most of them are the. Marked in red, and what I was told that most of those are just crown and berm issues.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
And that's pretty easily fixed, as I said.
Yeah.
Maybe a pain. Yeah. It'll be a pain this summer. It's going to take a lot of extra time. But
they have 20 years to fix those.
Yeah. But run around. You know, so when he's upgrading, he can just check them off.
Yeah. We've been actually developing a list.
Yeah.
Because I've got to get him. I know our road had a third of it washed out. He knows about it.
Yeah. The problem with the inventory that as it was given to us is that. They have best management practices for each segment that they've highlighted, but we don't have that information yet.
And I think one of the things Chance and I talked about is he mentioned at the seminar he went to, when you have road damage, FEMA's going to want to know what it was like beforehand.
Right.
So one of the things he's probably going to bring up is getting a digital camera that has GPS coordinates on it, so when they fixed a piece of road, you could photograph it and it would time and date it.
Right.
And that way, when FEMA comes and we said, no, this is what it looked like last summer or this summer.
What I've been talking with the road crew about, and it's been recommended to them, to me, is that we actually get them a pad.
Sure, and that's Chance is going to, when we finally talk, that's one of the things that came up was...
So they can do that documentation. We, you know, for any of these grants, we have to document before and after.
Right. Particularly when you have another Irene event. They're not just going to pay for a washed out piece of road. They're going to say, well, if it was a mess before, we're not going to. So you've got to have some proof that you actually had taken care of the road in the first place.
So that they can have that in any of road issues. They can take a picture.
And they geolocate and time it.
He has been anyways, right? I think Harry had a camera in the truck.
I think the camera's among the missing.
Turned up missing.
Harry did take pictures of stuff that they did, projects.
Right, so. While I have been on the select board, I've been taking pictures for them. And we do have, so for all the grants we have before, we have to have those.
So you have photos.
But they could do this anytime when they're out. And,
Just once you've graded a road nice, like for example, we clean it up nice, fix a culvert, just take a photograph. Put it in the file or get an electronic file on the computer.
Yeah. And they can also use a pad, to measure the slope to know how to deal with ditches. It would be of benefit to them to have that. So other towns are starting to use crews. So
welcome to high tech.
Yeah. And it looks like we could probably, in part of our budget. Good night, Norman.
Coming and going already?
Well,
all right, see you, Norman.
Did you have something that, were you waiting for the camera to be off, or do you?
No, just if you
If you have something you'd like to say, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, Patrick was in earlier already once. And
yeah, Patrick was here while we did
he
this.
He made it back. He came back. You came back.
I had to leave and came back.
Somewhere. Yeah. No, I went to the meeting up in Harvard.
Mm-hmm. Oh, tonight?
The only real big discussion was on the composition of the future board.
That's what I think.
Okay.
And Diana's proposal got a lot of traction, but I think there are mostly people there from Woodbury and Stanley and Greensboro, which were almost unanimously in favor of what she had said.
As far as an equal representation for all three towns?
Hers was the 5.
Right.
Yeah, 5.
5 for Hardwick and 2-2-2.
Yeah, that's what you have.
I see how that would work. Yeah,
you made it on camera anyways.
Yeah, that's
now you're famous. Can I have your autograph?
I've been here before. You guys are used to it, but
Patrick was here and we talked about the lease and conveyance, and the select board is in favor of doing the lease. Mm-hmm. And we talked some about the special meeting on Thursday night. We didn't formally make a decision about the lease. We would like to have the first few minutes of that meeting, just if anybody has issues with what we've decided, what we would like to decide, we'll hear them out. And then the select board will make a formal vote on going with the lease. And then we'll get on to the lease. By then, we should have a revised lease from Paul Giuliani. He sent one today. I sent it to you.
Yeah, and I sent back my comments.
Okay, great. And he's going to try to take in those comments and revise the lease again from those comments by Wednesday, so that everybody who would be at that meeting Thursday night could have had a little bit of time anyway to look at it.
Yeah, how the bids coming?
There were two bids.
They're really far apart.
Yeah, they're far apart.
They're like $50,000 difference on $100,000.
Okay,
you're not allowed to say that.
We didn't discuss the money part at all. We got two bids. They are far apart. From Rod Roofing and from Watershed Consulting
Construction.
There is a significant difference between the two bids.
Yeah, I think so.
I'm going to vet that with, I'm going to bring it with, to talk to Larry Eldred about it, and then we'll do some vetting on
that. Just raises a red flag in my book.
Yeah, and then we'll make a formal decision with the school board at the next select board meeting.
That'd be this Thursday?
No.
No,
that'll be
2 weeks from tonight or whenever we decide.
Whenever we decide. The select board will be the group, the entity making the actual award decision, but we will want to hear and share and discuss with the school board.
Thanks. Thank you, Lord.
sure.
Yeah, because my concern is when you have that much spread, that's huge.
Yeah.
In that size bid. So you're either not, somebody missed a big piece of it.
Yeah.
Possibly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I want to make a few calls on that one.
You know what I'm trying to say? So the number, that's a big, big difference.
Yeah. So just one other thing with the, we need to sign this tonight, or it would be good if we could sign it tonight. last week, Greg Parkhurst and I met with Shauna Clifford, the district manager for District 7, which is the district we're now in. We went over the proposed fiscal year 20 highway budget, and then she does some stuff with figures, and then VTrans comes up with the amount that they're going to give to the town towards the highway budget. So for class 2 roads, the VTrans will be giving us $20,700. For class 3 roads, they'll be giving us $48,430 for a total of $69,130. We need to sign this, and then I need to send it back to Shauna. So, is that? I guess, you know, I don't really know. We don't really approve it. We could say we don't want the money, I guess.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's what it is.
Yeah.
You don't see that one.
So, yeah, that's how the other one was. Yeah,
for one. So we should all sign it.
You've done this before. That's about in keeping with what we normally have.
It's pretty much the same.
I'm going by not knowing anything at the moment. I wouldn't trust my judgment right now.
It's based on the amount of miles. We have to meet a certain amount that the town itself is spending on its highway budget.
And that's for summer and winter maintenance?
Yeah. So, and it's figured out summer, and she does break it down summer and winter. But we have to meet a certain amount, which we always do. And then the amount that we receive in revenue from VTrans is based on the mileage for the roads that we have, the Class 2 mileage, which we have 5.05
miles
of road, and we have 31.82 miles of Class 3 roads, and we have roughly 25 miles of Class 4 roads.
County roads all Class 3, huh?
Yes. As far as I know, the only Class 2 roads that we have are Foster Hill Road and Cabot Road. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'll send you the digital copy of this just so you have it.
Do we have to have a vote on that?
I don't believe we do. We just have to sign it.
Okay.
We, the Select Board of Woodbury, certify that funds raised by municipal taxes are equivalent to or greater than a sum of at least $300,000 per mile. $300 per mile, sorry. For each mile.
We can pave all the roads now.
So we know we would never meet the match.
No.
So, $300 per mile for each mile of Class 1, 2, and 3 town highway miles that we have. And Shauna has checked to make sure that's true. So we're basically certifying that we have met the match, which she already checked on to make sure that we have. So this is the 8th of April, 2019. And I guess I'll just stick this in there and send it back.
Did you want this back, by the way? It has all your notes on there.
Yeah, maybe I will take it back.
I have the digital copy.
So I'm going to put that with this and put it in here. So all right. So we're pretty much done. So
we have to figure out a new date for
meeting. So April 22nd, that's the next new Union District meeting. I would really like to be there. So there'll be a floor vote on picking the new Union District representatives.
So you want to try to shoot for the 23rd, or do you want to go to a different week, like a 29th?
The 23rd is not good for anybody involved with the fire department.
Yeah, so I could do, let me just get to my schedule here.
Yeah, the 24th or the 25th, I guess.
I'm teaching I'm teaching ladders in Morrisville on the 24th.
Okay, that
Morrisville, so actually, I can do the 25th.
All right, the 25th would be better for me. I work in Burlington all day on the 24th, so I'd have to pretty much.
23rd is fine. On the 24th, I'm teaching a class.
The 25th, son.
Would that work for you?
Yep.
Okay.
So same time, 6 o'clock.
Yep. So everything else would be the same. April 25th. Okay, and I don't think we really need to vote on that. We just need to agree on it. And I'll make sure that I'll put a notice about that change of date before the agenda.
The station committee is the 18th.
Yeah.
Yeah, you remember, it's not this Wednesday. It's next. Yeah. No, this it's the 18th. Thursday, yeah. The 18th, we're talking to architects.
Yep.
Okay.
And the only other thing I wanted to just let you guys know is that the town forest did receive an award from the grant that they put in for the trails. They didn't receive the full amount for the award. So I know the Conservation Commission has been negotiating with the Vermont Youth Conservation Corps on doing just a part of the trail. We were awarded $12,000 and I think the full grant was around 47,000. So, and the people that award the grant that we applied for was said that, you know, just resubmit it next year, probably get another little chunk. So it sounds like we'll be kind of developing this trail piecemeal over the next few years. But hopefully,
it's a start.
It's a start. Yeah. So this summer there will be there has to be an archaeological survey. And then whether or not the section of the trail will be built this summer, or depending on when that survey is done, or whether it would happen next summer.
How much a survey costs?
I think we figured that the survey would cost about $3,000.
There's still some money left.
Yeah, so there'll be money left. And that's it on my agenda. Let me just check, because we've been all over the...
Yeah, we bounced all over, I believe, and saved the world.
I think we pretty much... So I will make a copy of these figures.
Yeah, which maybe scan it and send it.
And maybe we'll actually find them somewhere here in our file.
So why do I have this?
And we can go over that next time.
Well, my last little quick comment on the paving part. Did we want to consider doing something with the parking lot, since we're not going to probably do?
I don't.
We're going to have to do some repairs.
We'll have to do some repair. We'll have to piecemeal it together until. Okay. It doesn't make sense to have somebody come. I mean, we should try to do, it would be cost effective, put it that way, to have the Valley Lake Road done and the Woodbury Village Street done at the same time. Okay. Otherwise, you've got a crew coming to do one little patch and then the following year.
What's the holdup, though, of not doing it all in one shot? What is it that you want to see first?
It's going to cost us more money.
Yeah, we don't have a price over there yet, though.
The holdup is getting the erosion issues done on Valley Lake Road before we pave.
Now, are the erosion issues going to be something that we couldn't just deal with after it was paved?
Not the ditching, and probably not.
Because if they're just going to dig a ditch down at the bottom of the schoolyard and divert
that
the
part,
water
that
there.
That part would not affect the... there is a culvert that goes underneath the school driveway, and that'll be running into a catch basin, which would then run into the a kind of water catch basement that'll be right behind the annex building.
Mm-hmm. I'm just wondering if we should at least get a quote on the town parking lot. Yeah.
We have a quote.
What was the quote? That was to tear it up and
$19,000 to and actually with the quote, the road crew would actually do the tearing up of it.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. I'm not certain we shouldn't seriously consider doing something with
that. We could do that section of it and then do the school driveway later.
Okay, it would be spending more money. To have somebody come and do that little section of road, we'd probably be looking at somebody small scale. Mm-hmm. And we would probably, be paying quite a bit more for doing the two parts together. I would like to see what we could do to just patch it up to get by for a summer or two. And then do the whole thing together.
But we may need to look at like having them patch it with hot mix instead of the cold patch, because it mm-hmm. didn't hold. That's mm-hmm. part of what expanded. I talked to a pavement guy that I know.
Yeah.
Part of our problem was we didn't fix it right last time.
Right.
He'll just say that hole's just going to keep it. Like right now, you're going to have to put fill in and compact it and bring that up, and then if they, you could probably get a couple years with real hot patch, but they'd have to rent a roller and put 2 or 3 inches of hot patch in there. Because it's a horrible mess. It's a, you know, it's...
I still think we ought to get bids on it at least, very least. We'll look at it and say, okay, it's too expensive to do it.
We have an estimate. We would have to, you know, put together an RFP.
It's a real mess because it's peeling up around the fire station.
Yeah, I agree it's a mess. I just, you know...
So why isn't Valley Lake Road ready now? That could be paved at the same time.
I've explained that a number of times.
We could do what's paved now, the portion of it. We just couldn't...
None of Valley Lake Road is paved.
Right, so we couldn't do that section, but we could put that off for a year.
Yeah, we got to do the remediation of the water issue.
Right. What's happening, I think I already talked about this tonight, but what's happening is that with the erosion, the municipal road, general permit, that whole area in the village has been addressed for the erosion issues. And it was done partly through the road inventory that the Planning Commission did, and also through a Kingsbury Branch watershed kind of survey that was done. So the recommendations are that that the ditching be done on the upper part of Valley Lake Road. Our road crew did that last year, so that's one thing off the list. But the other thing is that the school parking lot would be sloped so that the water from the parking lot would go towards the bank that's where Valley Lake Road comes down.
Okay.
That steep bank. And there would be kind of a catch basin there that would collect the water. There would actually be two basins. So if there was a heavy rain issue, it would collect in there. Mm-hmm. Any of the gravel and stuff from the parking lot would go into there. And then, so the catch basins would be at two different heights. Gravel would get caught in one. It filled up, the water would flow in, but most of the gravel would stay there. That would run down along the ditch, along the driveway, and then go into a culvert underneath the driveway, this school parking lot area, into another catch basin between the driveway and the school annex basin. And then behind the annex building, there'd be this very fancy, convoluted infiltration system that would catch that water and any erosion from the road coming down and separate out the erosion from the water, and then the water would infiltrate into the ground around there. It wouldn't run into the Kingsbury Branch. And whether, you know, that again, it wouldn't be in the road. But all of the, you know, before those are fixed, there's still going to be the issue of the water, you know, running down the road. So I'm just worried.
Probably got to lower that road too.
That
runs in the fire station. Yeah.
So how far up Valley Lake are you going
just,
to pay?
Just past the school.
Yeah,
just past the school.
Yeah. It would be a big benefit. Really needs it.
So what we're trying to eliminate is, you know, the condition that little section of road is after you turn off Route 14 to walk into school.
Because then they could salt it too, and it would help with our apron and the road, because it built up awful this year.
And the thinking is to wait until all of the erosion issues are fixed before we pave it, because, you know, we could pave it and then it could just go to hell.
I wouldn't even pave it. I would just pave it in front of the fire station and in that section of it. You don't have to go up.
You're just talking about the town parking lot.
Yeah, you're just talking about
the town parking lot.
Yeah, the whole town. I really would like to take a serious look at maybe in 2 weeks we'll see it's not as bad, but I think when that thing dries out, you're going to be appalled at how bad the pavement is.
Yeah, because you don't have to go up past the brook even, you know.
It starts right at the edge of the town road, and it would just come across and then down through between the post office and the fire department.
Get one section done this year and then work towards the grant to get the...
You put in for the Better Roads thing to do the study this year, right?
It's not really through Better Roads. It's
whatever it's called.
I can't even remember what it's called.
But they're studying it's up by the school.
Yeah, in front of the fire.
In front of the village is all.
No, that's just us. Well, actually, there is another, and I did mention that there is another one of those infiltration basins that is a part of this whole project for the village that would go between the fire department and the post office. You know, that swale
where
that they have now, where the
yeah.
water runs directly into the
Kingsbury Bridge.
Would it be in the grass area or in
the paved
area?
It would be pretty much in the paved area. Mm-hmm. So
that's gonna be a tough place to put it.
There's water lines.
Yeah, well, the thing, once
your leach fields in back of that building, right?
Mm-hmm. Once it's in there, it's totally underground. There'll be like a manhole cover for the catch basin. Okay. So the whole thing, you can drive over it.
I'm just thinking though, but it's not much above water table there. At best,
it's
too
far. Yeah, it's just going to leach. Well, we can look at this parking level. We just talk about it the next meeting.
Right, too. Yeah.
See how bad it is. I just think it's
The least costly way is to do them both at the same time. If we're going to just do, and I don't want to do like I'll say it on camera, half-assed, paving job just to get it paved in front of the town hall. Mm-hmm. And then 2 years from now, we have the same problem.
Well, I wouldn't do it half-assed. Yeah.
No, if I did, I'd want to dig it up and redo it all.
We don't have to do the whole thing in one shot. Just saying, we could break it in pieces.
If we can do it in pieces, it's just going to cost the town more money in the long run.
Yeah.
Well, probably not just a little bit, probably quite a bit. I mean, for someone to come and do a little, well, it's like doing somebody's driveway, really.
Mm-hmm. But that's what they do.
That's what they do. So we could have a...
Because in a couple weeks, we'll know just how bad it is, and it's pretty bad.
Right.
Yeah, I hate to throw a patch onto something that isn't going to last through the year. Just why not fix it right when you do it? But you can do it in two different projects.
Well, if we patched it, it would probably be that we patch it and it lasts.
It would get through until next year or whatever.
And then we would patch it again. Or we would work. But, if the patch is a kind of a minimal expense to do and it solves the problem, waiting for a better solution. That might be.
Well, maybe we could discuss it. We could take a walk down the hill and have a.
Yeah, takes a lot.
Right. We're all at the school on Thursday night. We can just kind of walk down there.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we're having a very tough time in the parking lot right now because it's just all coming up and then making a horrible mess to try to wash hoses and things in. Mm-hmm. But really needs to be addressed because our other building's flooded and muddy, and now we've got this muddy mess in front of our fire station, making it next to impossible to.
Yeah. Well, if you could just back the trucks up to the side of the building where the swale is, then the water would run.
Yeah, well, that's coming up too, but it isn't as bad yet.
So we'll talk about some.
All right.
Figure it out.
Put it on the next one.
We did get a bid for $19,000 to.
And that's not horrible for all.
That's not horrible at all.
And that's what the town group pulled the old payment up.
Yep.
Wow. Yeah.
That's
not bad.
We have
not bad at all.
My concern is whether we would get somebody who could do the proper job they're interested in coming to do that small.
That's probably big enough.
So
could.
What would happen if you had the road crew rip up what's there now and leave it until you get ready for the rest of Valley Lake Road and then pave the whole thing?
I mentioned that to Paul and he was worried about mud. If we could rip it up and put some pretty
nice
substantial
gravel.
Stone down there, that might be a good solution for
the
time.
Could
be
now. Yeah.
That would be certainly cheaper than.
Yeah, because if we had dirt, because I can tell you the other building where the dirt is, it's a huge muddy mess.
Yeah.
You can't get
it. Yeah, that's. Thank you. That's a good point. We could do that.
Yeah.
Could put it some 1-inch stone or a little bit larger, and of course then you'll have to deal with
like
stone.
I hate to keep kicking the can down
pile the
road.
Stone
yeah,
up and
we do have some money to we could do a good part of this and do it right.
Because it really works good now that they've been salting it too. It keeps the ice, because if we have any buildup, I can't get the truck in the door.
Right. Yeah.
And that's what I'm hoping when they do Valley Lake Road, I'm going to want to see what it's going to cost for us to add extra to get that little apron. Done on our building so that they can salt all that, because we had this much ice build up there this year.
Yeah, the apron I think would come.
It's just a little piece. It's only this much wider than the road.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure all they could do is out a little more, half a truckload or something.
I shouldn't change the estimate at all.
No, that's what I'm saying. I was going to talk to whoever we ended up hiring and say, how much did you string? That way when they, because it would make the road department's job a lot easier because they could just swing in there and then salt it and it would clear it off. That's what happens at the end.
I know when we did the lower part of Cabot Road, the Smiths had their driveway paved.
Yeah, they're right there. It's really cheap.
Yeah, and they pay for that, but everything was there, so it made it cheap for them to do that.
Okay, talked about it enough.
Okay, all right. Yeah, so.
My view.
Can I make a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.